Okay, begin. Thank you all for being here. I'm going to acknowledge the Kaurna people. City of Salisbury, we are meeting on the traditional country of the Kaurna people of the Outback Plains and pays respect to elders past and present. We recognise and respect their cultural heritage, beliefs and relationship with the land. Acknowledge that they are of continuing importance to the Kaurna people living.
Council Prayer, members, Father in Heaven, we thank you for the wondrous resources of our city, for its people, its environment and its sense of community. Thank you for the opportunity to now deliberate over how best to help our community. Please bless that we will respect one another and that we will all do our best to make decisions that will help our community to grow and prosper. Bless our efforts this day in God's name.
May be seated. A big welcome to the councillors that are online. I'm not sure who they are, but I do know that a big welcome should go to Amy Paconi Cramery. I've probably pronounced that wrong, but we'll get used to you, Amy. She's a new General Manager of Community Development and she is listening in. And what councillors have we got? Sarah. Hello, Sarah. Tasha. How are you, Natasha?
Very well. How are you?
Thank you. Is that just the two of you then? Is that it?
Lisa, I'm here. I'm just trying to get my camera to work.
Hello, Lisa. Welcome. We'll start asking if there are no apologies, there are no leaves. Oh, Maria, Councillor Blackmore is an apology, a late apology. Public question times, there are no public deputations, there are no deputations, petitions, no petitions. Confirmation of minutes on the 28th of the confirmation of minutes on the 28th of June 2021, Council minutes. Moved by Councillor Prolita. Seconded by Councillor Woodman. All those in favour? Against? Carried. 28th of June confidential council meeting. Moved by Councillor Brenfell. Seconded by Councillor Reardon. All those in favour? Against? Carried. Committee reports from 5.1 to 5.3. Councillor Duncan.
Oh, could I withdraw 412, please?
That's urban services. We're doing, at the moment, committee reports.
Oh, okay. So, yeah, sorry, mine's come up.
That's okay.
Sorry, apologies.
Committee reports, policy and planning to committee reports to 5.3. Would someone like to move those? Councillor Buchanan is moving, seconded by Councillor Reardon. There's no discussion. I'll put that. Am I going too fast for you guys?
All good, thank you.
All those in favour? And for people online, all those in favour? Might be if we can't see your picture, a yes will do, or a no. I can see them down there.
Point of order, Madam Mayor. Is it possible for us just to put our hand up, you know, using an icon, emoji?
I can see you now.
Because when I do that, I don't see it. Sorry?
I'm sorry, I can't understand what you're saying, Councillor Henderson. Are you happy to...
I'm using the emoji to vote, but it's not showing up in the chat as a, you know, a handshake or anything. So I just wanted to confirm whether we could use that as a form of voting, or would you rather just see us put our hands up?
Writing that would be great. Thank you. Writing.
Thank you.
All those in favour online?
Yes.
Already did it for the council.
Yes.
Yes, that is carried. Thank you. Moving on to, sorry, 5.4, Urban Services, Councillor Duncan. Is this the one you wanted?
5.2, Finance and Corporate.
Sorry?
We're up to 5.2 now.
5.1.2. No, that one.
No, we're on 5.2, Finance.
Mayor, can I have 4.1.1?
Can I have one voice at a time, please? Councillor Buchanan.
4.1.1.
4.1.1, yes.
Oh, sorry, Finance, my bad.
We're on 5.2.
5.2.
Finance and Corporate.
That, yeah, they're asking for 4. I was under the impression that we moved in block, but I'm happy to go back because Councillor Buchanan, we were moving from 5. Doesn't matter. If you'd like to go back, I'm happy to. So what you're saying is we've moved, Councillor.
Nice point of order, Mayor, clarification. My understanding is we're up to 5.2, which is Finance. A couple of people got confused and actually asked for a couple of things to be withdrawn for later items, but not the ones we're considering right now.
I believe that the first item, 5.1, was moved by Councillor Buchanan and seconded by Councillor Reardon.
So we've dealt with
and
5.1.
Moved and dealt with. I did move the block, but I'm happy to go back to 5.2.
I thought we were on 5.2 right now.
But that is on block.
That's what we're on now. 5.2 on block for 5.2, is that correct?
We've moved and moved 5.1. We're now going to 5.2. Right.
That's what I just said.
Which is Finance.
Which is not correct. Tell me.
Through the presiding member, so the mayor called items 5.1, 5.2, and 5.3 en bloc, which was moved by Councillor Buchanan and seconded by Councillor Reardon. The mayor is indicating that, considering the confusion that this caused, she's happy to go back to 5.2 if the members.
Well, we never actually.
Councillor Proleta.
Well, on my papers here, 5.1 is policy, 5.2 is finance, 9.3 is governance.
But they're all under committee reports.
Yes.
So they're all under 5.1.
I thought you'd only passed 5.1.
Yes. So 5.1 to 5.3. I understand they're all different, but they're all under committee.
Okay.
But I'm happy to go back to 5.2.
Now, if you're moving them in block, then you would have moved all the committee reports. It takes us.
No, I just moved item 5.
Point of order, clarity, Madam Mayor. I moved 5.1.
You did move that.
That's right, and that's all I moved.
Okay.
So we're up to 5.2, Finance and Corporate Services.
That's exactly what I'm saying. So are you moving that one?
No.
Councillor Greville, did you want 5.2?
I'm happy to move 5.2.
I'm happy to move that. Do I have a second? I'm sorry if there's confusion, but that's just how it reads.
Keep going.
So committee report. So 5.2 is seconded by Councillor Whitman. Are there any speakers? If not, I'll put that all those in favour. And the next one, I guess, is 5.3, moved by Councillor who?
You need to check the votes of the people on them.
Oh, I do. Thank you. The votes, may I have the vote? Did you hear that clearly, that we're voting on 5.2? And a show of hands as you're all supporting it. Good. Thank you. It moves, seconded, and now carried. Now we're moving to 5.3. Do I have a mover for 5.3? Councillor Reynolds. Moved it, seconded by Councillor Buchanan.
No, I'm withdrawing it.
Drawing 5.3. Which report?
302
has been moved by Councillor Buchanan. Councillor Reynolds, did you want to second that?
Drawing it. Well, Councillor Buchanan's withdrawing 302. I'm happy to move the remainder.
Good. That's what I want, the remainder. Although, and I have a seconder for the remainder. Councillor Proleta. All those in favour? Thanks. Carried. Now we're just 302 under the 5.3.
Thanks, Madam Mayor. And I appreciate what the committee's trying to do. Members would be aware, going back a few years ago, particularly before we started the process with the new hub, is we're looking at a local content That was part of our procurement policy. I thought we did have some wording in there, but I can't find it. I appreciate the committee's efforts. Councillor Reynolds and Grenfell, by the look of it, to put in some wording along Councillor Brooke in regards to obviously the circular economy of Norma and also some bits and pieces around supporting the economic development of the Northern region, particularly the City of Salisbury or Northern region. But in saying that, the policy does need to go further, and rather than making some, policy amendments right here for council, I'd like to suggest the following motion, and that is that one, we'll move the following motion. One, council notes and receives the information. Two, the administration bring back a further report, including the additions of minor editorial changes and the following amendments, and those two dot points. And three, further advice and consideration of increasing local content procurement practices within the City of Salisbury. I'll get a seconder, Madam Mayor, I'll continue.
Councillor Brooke is seconding that.
Mayor, I think it's relatively straightforward. It's been a strong vision of this council for at least half a dozen years now that we want to try and have as much local procurement. Originally, when I first proposed this some years ago, I did put a mandatory figure in, but I respect the administration's advice. There were some issues, practicalities around that. But in saying that, I think the wording within the current policy certainly doesn't go far enough into where I would like to see it. I appreciate the committee has done some good changes, some proposed amendments in terms of looking at how we can incorporate circulating the circular economy and also working with Norma and other relevant organisations. I do have some reservations about that in one sense, not against the principle of the circular economy and using recycled materials. It will further enshrine some of the practices that we are doing in terms of our ovary seal program. So there are some practices that we're doing and some road mixtures that we're using for road resale and also road replacement, which I do have a strong issue with because it has caused a lot of issues and that. So I think by looking at the further report will give us some time to digest and try and appreciate and reflect the intent of what the committee was trying to do in that regard, because it is a very important principle, but not locking us into, a practice where we must go down this path. And also the key bit, which is supporting the economic development of the City of Salisbury. But I wanted to go one step further, and that is with part three, further advice, consideration of procurement practice in the City of local content and job creation in the City of Salisbury, which is the essential part of part three. So part three, I'll just wait for staff to get it up on the board. Further advice and consideration of amendments to increase local procurement practices and job creation in the City of Salisbury.
And the second is happy with that?
That's the motion there. And so hopefully we'll have that report come back. I'm not putting a time frame on it because I'd rather get it right. No doubt staff can probably bring it back next month. But I think the important thing is that we do give the time considering this. Business as usual, in the sense that the existing procurement policy is in place and that will continue to operate. But when staff do bring back this further proposed amendment, draft policy with the amendments as recommended by the Governance Committee and also part three of tonight's motion, we'll be able to give further consideration.
Are there any other speakers? Councillor Woodman.
I'm not going to advance this. I'm happy to see a report come back. Policy as it stands does recommend those things anyway. This is just the amendments to the policy, but the actual policy we were passing had those issues in it. But I'm happy to see if there's any elaborations that could.
No. Is there any more discussion before I put that? Councillor Brooks.
Just quickly, for those that were in the committee, we obviously try to capture some of the feedback that Councillor Cannon It's mentioned in particular Councillor Reynolds with the Norma, myself with the local, and I think that was the sentiment of the committee as well, was that we wanted to prioritise and support local. And I support this motion in that I think that it is sensible that if we take our time to be able to review the policy, that there may be opportunities for it to be improved. Noting that the committee only had half of the council while getting the input. I support the motion.
And just a clarification there, part three, further advice and consideration, further amendments to the procurement policy, the aim to increase local procurement practices, to increase local procurement practices. Increase local contact and local job creation.
There's no more discussion. Is there any discussion from the team?
No.
In that case, I'll put that, not ask of Councillor Reynolds.
Thanks, Madam Mayor. I've got no problems with what we've got here. Last week in the committee, and Councillor Brooke put up about the northern jobs in Salisbury region as well. We asked about encapsulating something similar to this. I think advice at the time was that, look, this is the policy that we lower level practices that will fill out some of that detail. So my expectation is that either A, this will come up with some policy amendments, or maybe not some policy amendments, but going from that dot point that's already there, some of our practices that are enacting the policy might come up with some amendments that are appropriate to capture what we've got here. By the way, happy for it to be there, happy for it to flow down into either our policy or our practices and the rest of our procurement framework and go from there. So happy with what we've got before us.
Thank you. Right of reply. In that case, I'd like to put that, all those in favour. Against. Carried. Thank you, people online. Moving now on to urban. And we're going from 5.4, from 405 down to 5.117. Are there any withdrawals?
411.
411 from Councillor Buchanan. Who's in that? Councillor Buchanan, 411.
413.
413, got that.
415.
415, yes.
422.
422, yes.
402.
Sorry?
402.
402.
And once, 41.
41.
Kamara Drive one. Sorry, my screen has gone on.
I think Adam wants to withdraw 415. Oh, no, sorry, 412.
412. Sorry.
Councillor Grenfell, is that the one you've just moved? No, 412. Got that.
402.
All right. And sorry, Councillor Henson. Do you want one? Who's put their hand up for us? Councillor Braun.
No.
Can I speak? Would like to withdraw US OB2.
Okay. Has someone moved the remainder?
I'm happy to move the remainder.
And a second, please, Councillor Woodman. All those in favour? Against, carried. Councillor Grenfell, 402.
Thanks, Madam Mayor. I just wanted to query that on future reports, that what was stated on the agenda for the committee was actually, sorry, I'm just going to pull it up. Clayton Road and Frost Road speed limit increase, which had already been dealt with. Martins Road was meant to actually be placed back on there. Has that happened?
Yes,
through. And that, when do I expect the report back?
I think the discussions I had was next month.
Because they may have put the Clayson Road, Frost Road one on there, but they also did a date of December 22, and I'm not willing to wait until then for Martin's Road. So next month?
That's my understanding.
Lovely.
Thank you. I'm happy to move that. I have a seconder for that, please. Councillor Woodman? All those in favour? Yes, carried. Councillor Buchanan, 411.
Mayor, I'd like to move recommended, and I understand Councillor Perlita would like to second that. And if I may, Mayor, I just want to note that this is a very significant milestone in terms of the project status of the urban community hub. As members would be aware, it's a statutory process that is required under the Local Government Act that we must go through and have Council consider a prudential report. The prudential report is a significant milestone. This is now forming the basis of where we're next. And I just wanted to express my thanks and appreciation to the CEO and the administration in terms of getting us to this stage. We did have a budget of $6.5 million for this project, noting that $500,000 that's actually from the feds, from state government funding. But in saying that, there's still a significant amount of ratepayers' money. And we are a little bit under budget, when I say a little bit, just a fraction, and I'm hoping that, by the end of the project, we'll be able to come under budget because it's certainly a very big investment for the western part of the city and hub that's going to be beneficial for all of the community. The only thing I just wanted to note to Council is that one of the things that we did flag from PCG, and I mentioned it in the services last week, is that we're really keen to see the community garden aspect and the shed. It's not a men's shed, it's the shed. It's going to be running our NDIS program where it's catering for people who are on NDIS, not just NDIS clients, but also one of the things we want to do is expand that program to be like a men's shed, certainly just for men. Have other programs. We've got a couple of days a week where the NDIS program aren't using it. So it gives us some flexibility to look at some programs for the run out of that. And my understanding there is that that particular shed and also the community garden could be ready as early as late this year or early next year. And one of the things that I've flagged with the administration and through other processes is that on behalf of our community council, we will see that some aspects of this facility is open to public before soft opening, which is scheduled mid next year. So there's no point having a part of this fantastic community asset ready and finished in January, all for it to sit idle and nothing happening until during next year. So CEO obviously has to go through and work with the project director and others in terms of making sure that the OcHealth side of it is looked at, whether we can have part of it operational whilst technically it's still a construction site. But I have confidence the CEO will be able to deliver on that. We can have skyscrapers being built and everything happening that you can see in the Adelaide CBD and still have people literally walking underneath some of these buildings while there's cranes overhead. I'm pretty sure we can manage to do that with the community hub.
Thank you. That
my pleasure, John.
Seconded by Councillor Perlita. Is there any more discussion? Online, team online? No? In that case, I'll put that. All those in favour? Against? Carry. Moving on to Councillor Duncan. 412.
Thank you. I have sent through a revised motion through to governance. Apologies, no one from East Ward was in committee last week. So it just got moved through as recommended, but we have made a change that it'd be one, that the report is received and noticed, two, council endorses option A minus the toilet facility for the replace space to proceed to community consultation, that a further report be presented back to the committee with the outcomes of the consultation and any changes to the concept plan as a result of the feedback with further refined costings for delivery of the play space. Next, four, council notes that any additional costs required outside the existing budget will be sought through savings within the infrastructure program, grant funding, future budget bids, or rescheduling of East Ward Place space renewals. I understand, obviously, the costs have come up pretty high, but I think the toilet block there is way, cost is way out of line, and it's not something that we're really that idea we threw in there. And we think there could be significant savings, especially with the soft fall. I don't believe some of the earthworks is needed, so I think there's enough in category A to go out to get consultation on. And I think there is significant cost we can pull back on that. And are we seeking whether this goes into next year's budget, and I'll put a budget bid in. I'm also prepared to put other projects in my ward, so I'm not looking to take any money away from any other ward councillors' playgrounds. This particular area was identified as an area where there is no playground anywhere near it, and with all the future of the development up to Murrah Drive, with the amount of houses about to go up in the next few years, it desperately needed playgrounds. Councillor Blackmore and I did some our own community consultation there. We did our own informal one. We had a street quarter meeting out there, and the feedback we got was this needs to be here. Like, we need something. And the location, we think, is just perfect. It may be there will be some residents putting in some feedback, that's for sure, that we'll have to address when it comes up. But we think it just lends in perfectly with the little pair of trails ahead from the behind the old spot all the way up to back of the Kurumara Drive development, all the way up to the Little Para Reservoir. So I commend this motion to you. I know that when the costings do come back, there'll be a significant amount of savings, especially with removing that toilet block. And one of the other reasons why we do need a bit of offset parking, and I don't care if that's Dolomite, doesn't need to be a car park, is because there is issues with on-street parking there. It is a bit dodgy coming around the bend from Stanford around to Queensborough. Is a bit of an issue there. A lot of residents actually querying whether they should be yellow line there. So on-street parking is not really an option. So formalising just some offset parking where there's a beautiful space for it would be good. But we don't need the toilet. But the key part is that we have just an accessible spot that can go down to the playground to go to the accessible swing, and possibly, depending on the money, like if the money is too much for the Flying Fox, that's something I'm prepared to cut as well. If that's accessible as well, just to tie into what we did a year and a half ago, where we promised that we would make as many playgrounds as we can accessible, and I want that to be a feature of this one. So with that, I'd like to go out for a new consultation with that, and when it comes back, then we'll have a deeper dive into the costs and see what we can do with it. So with that, motion to you. I understand Councillor Blackmore was going to try to, but I'm not sure she has.
It's been seconded by Councillor Grenfell.
Grenfell.
So is there any more discussions? Not
Madam Mayor?
Yes?
Councillor Blackmore?
Oh, hello, Councillor. Yes, please.
I just would like to put my support behind this motion. I think that from the feedback that we received from the community, it is very much so needed. Many of the families in that area of the East Ward have very young families, and even from their feedback from the consultation, the fact that so many families did show up, it showed that there was a really strong need for it. And I'll be looking forward to the consultation that council undertakes in order to make the best choices for our community to address their needs while keeping our budget in line. And I agree with Councillor Duncan that we don't need an excess of like a toilet, for example, there, knowing that it is a local play space and people do live nearby. But as it currently is, there's no playgrounds in that general vicinity for our residents. And, you know, when we're setting those kind of standards, you know, within, I think it's around 500 metres or so, there's many houses in that area that unfortunately don't meet that standard. So we're really looking forward to this project and looking forward to hear that feedback. I put this motion to the councillors and encourage them to support it.
Councillor Buchanan.
Thanks, Madam Mayor. And look, I certainly agree with the intent and what the councillors are trying to achieve here. Just perhaps some suggestions about the way it's worded. I think it might be more prudent that we actually identify how we're going to pay for this before we're, and that it's actually going to happen before it goes out to public consultation, because I don't think it's probably really appropriate to go out to public consultation on saying this is what we're doing when we're still yet to identify, because the way Park Falls read, notwithstanding what Councillor Duncan said, and I completely agree that he made it clear that if this is going to happen, it's going to be done within existing projects within the East Ward. That may not happen, so it doesn't take away. The way Park 4 is working at the moment, the savings will be sought through the infrastructure program, and also you know, that part there leaves it, I guess, that door open, so to speak. So perhaps if we can make it a fait accompli that yes, this is the council's intent, we are going ahead with this, and that the a further report comes back where it says that a further report being presented to council committee with the outcomes of the consultation and any changes to the concept plan as a result of feedback, that report, rather than council notes are any additional, but that report also identifies the savings required through future budget bids of rescheduling or eastward and or whatever grants or something like that. Yeah, fully support the intent, yep. But we've just got to...
Yeah, I know. So we've leave at the meeting. I would like to vary the motion to part four.
Are we happy to give him leave to change this motion?
Sure.
Yes? Yes. Yes.
I know what the changes are, Mayor, but I'm sure we'll agree.
Okay. Essentially, yes. So we'll go
into, alter it.
Into so change four to after the community consultation, additional costs required to look through savings within the infrastructure program grant funding, budget bid or rescheduling of eastward place-based renewals. I'd also expect that once it does go to the community consultation, that the actual cost of the tour is not. As well, so I would hope that that cost that does go out to community consultation still there as in part two. And I think that covers the intent of what you mean, Councillor Buchanan.
Yeah.
Yep. Yep, no, that is better. Yep. So,
Councillor, a second or something. Were that all those are happy for the change in that? Show of hands, please. In that case, I'll put the motion. All those in favour? Okay, moving on to Councillor Buchanan, 413.
Thank you, Mayor. And I'd like to move what I recommended in the committee, and I understand Councillor Hood would like to second that.
I'm happy to take Councillor Hood.
Look, Mayor, I thank our senior social planner, Julie Douglas, for quite a comprehensive report. I understand where some of the work is going in regards to this. As you'll note from the original motion that we did look at, we're going to have two separate policies in place, essentially. One is our CCTV network, and also a separate CCTV policy procedures for our community safety and CCTV program. In the CCTV program, which is primarily going to be focused on the, I guess, it's the trial that we did, which is the home driving element, the illegal dumping and also illegal graffiti. So we need to do a little bit more work on that, development of that, and we're just proposing that we set up a working group and back to the committee in due time. I did go and spend talk about this at length in the committee. I'm happy to go through it again tonight, but I won't bore you. I'm happy to answer any questions.
Is there any more discussion? Screenshot. Okay, in that case, I'd like to put that. All those in favour? Against, carried. Councillor Henningsen, are you in favour or against? In favour, thank you. That's carried.
In favour, thank you.
Moving on to 422, Councillor Mulline. 415, sorry.
Thanks, Madam Mayor. I'd like to move this in two parts. The first one is I'd like to move 1, 2, and 3 up until the words 21-22 after St Kilda Adventure Parks and Surrounds. I'll get a seconder.
Councillor
Perlita. Because I understand that the next part, which I'm moving as a separate motion now, Councillor Wood may have a conflict of interest. So I'm moving this so no one's got a conflict for this part. And everything needs to speak, so I think it's pretty straightforward.
Okay, I have a seconder in, Councillor Perlita. Is there any discussion? No, I'd like to put that. All those in favour? Against, carry.
Mayor, if I may, I'd like to make a further motion that the Salisbury North Oval from 2023-24 into 21-22, that we bring forward the Salisbury from 22-23 into the 21-22 as part of the 1784 irrigation program. Should there be an impact to the budget, further report be provided?
Councillor, what is the second of that?
No. Councillor, please. I can get a second of that, amazing.
Councillor Perlita seconded that one.
Councillor Perlita, yep, go on.
Councillor Hood, declaration.
Got a problem, Councillor Reynolds? Did you want to speak?
No, it's all right, Ben.
Councillor Hood.
Thank you, Madam Mayor. I'd like to declare an actual conflict of interest due to I am a board member of the Salisbury North Football Club, which is involved with this. I will take no part in the vote and I'll leave the room.
Okay. We then they've moved. Someone like to now move this.
Councillor Perlita seconded it.
Okay, all those in favour? Thanks. Councillor Henningsen, I'm not getting that. All those in favour and against? Harry. Okay, moving on to 5.6, innovation and business. Councillor Buchanan, I haven't got you as withdrawn.
I'm sorry, I'd have a heart attack. Look, Your Worship, I wish to move as recommended by the committee. I understand Councillor Hood would also like to.
Councillor Hood. Thank you, Councillor Hood.
Look, Madam Mayor, this has been a long time coming and I completely understand why it has taken staff an extra month to bring back this report. My original motion did ask for it for June, but this is a very big undertaking. And the information that we have before us tonight clearly articulates that there is a job ahead of us. Well, not so much us, but certainly ahead of the state government. And the motion that I moved last week, and I think it's important to really understand what I've moved and I guess long-term implications on this council and the direction that I'm asking this council to go in, is that we understand that this is obviously clearly a state government road. To have Waterloo Corner Road and Kings Road, to have Waterloo Corner Road upgraded to a high dual carriageway at a high standard is $44, and to do Kings Road is $52 million. Now, the motion that I put forward at the committee last week, and I thank the committee for its support, is that at this stage that council does endorse the full duplication, which is of option two as a preferred option for Kings Road. There's no two ways about the need of having Kings Road west of Salisbury Highway all the way through duplicated to two lanes. I don't think anybody in this room would disagree with that. As much as I would personally love to have dual carriageway for the whole section of that Waterloo Corner Road west of Oliver, in our part of the neck of the woods that we share with Northport. The reality is there still needs to be more work done, whether it's going to be dual carriageway or single carriageway. There are ramifications and unforeseen consequences carriageway through that section and not all the other, all through the whole rest of the way. And, you know, I did give a lot of thought and consideration and had some good discussions with the CEO and other relevant staff in regards to promoting you. Other reasons why or may not we should do that, but the motion does say that we do give further consideration to the full duplication of Waterloo Corner Road following the outcome of the North West Road Network planning strategy. So it's a bit too premature for us as a council to, you know, signal our intent to the state government and to other parties about having a dual carriageway, you know, in that section of Waterloo Corner Road. But what we can all agree, and I'm sure we all do agree on, is that come what may, there needs to be some significant upgrades to Warwick Corner. If you look at the high end for option one, we're still looking at the order of $1 million. What that will do is actually give us storm water carriageway, the curbing, the guttering, taking in outlets where people can, you know, buses and people can pull off, and you're going to know, safety. It'll fix the roundabout there at the intersection of Heaston Road, other safety improvements, but you don't get much bang for buck for $20 million. So the real issue we have now, Your Worship, is getting the state government and the federal government, also the state government, because it's their road, on board. So what we're doing now as part of this motion is that we'll request that of the design report that we've now commissioned on their behalf. I think it's fair to say that we as a council has done more work in terms of costing and design of these two key roads than what the state government has done in 20 years. I don't think that's a big call. I think that's the reality. And, I'm sure that has been, I guess, somewhat confirmed when our own administration, senior administration staff have met with their counterparts at DIT. And when we've heard some of the, I'm covering what's confidential, so I can't really go into too much detail, but when we heard some proposals and some of the concepts talked about Park Terrace, I think it only reinforces, I guess, some of the, the lack of understanding and really appreciation of these significant road networks, which is why this council, Madam Mayor, at the start of this term, made it a key priority as part of our city plan, our key strategic directions for this council. We've enshrined it in the CEO's KPIs. We've done a number of representations at a state and federal level, and now this is the last part. What we can do is in terms of, you know, giving the state government their job on a platter, and hopefully ask both the government and the opposition to come to the party. The other thing that this motion is doing is setting council up in terms of understanding that we do have a role to play, and that I have asked through this motion that a further report be presented to the August 21 committee meeting, identifying a special purpose grant funding that could apply for help to fund these road upgrades, and more importantly, the creation of an economic future infrastructure fund that council and the state government can contribute. So this is actually us as a council setting the key strategic direction and putting it into practice, where we will identify opportunities to continue getting state and federal government funding, whether it be Infrastructure SA or Infrastructure Australia, and more importantly, us having to make our own contribution when the time is right. How we do that, there's plenty of discussion and ways we can discuss that down the track towards some upgrades to these two key roads. So look, I thank staff and colleagues for their support along the way, and I think that we can probably give some confidence to our residents that we certainly take these issues seriously. The council has been fair dinkum about doing what it can. We have put real money on the table in terms of addressing parts that we need to do that for. But there is more work to be done and done by.
Thank you, Councillor. Is there any discussion on this? Councillor Woodman.
I have to agree with Councillor Buchanan about the state of both roads and King's Road, obviously I live very close to it, so I understand it completely often. But Waterloo Corner Road, the last time I said, what are they thinking? This road is terrible. If you look at the South Road, the linkages to South Road, and I can think of perhaps Panatalinga Road that goes through from South Road, that's not in that state. I mean, that's an east-west linkage in the southern suburbs. They wouldn't put up with that. It's disgusting to think that Waterloo Corner Road and King's Road are both major linkage roads in our state, because they are significant state roads. And you look in the southern suburbs, and I think, well, if that was down there, if that was what was happening in linking South Road, there would be a huge outcry. And I just think we really have to push really hard for these two roads. Kings Road has been upgraded a few times at the top end, amazingly. I don't even know why they did the last one, to be honest with you. But where there's not even drainage, I think is deplorable. And it's a main connecting road to Port Wakefield,
expressway, and it really has to be in better condition. And I just don't know where they're coming. They have to have it brought to their attention every given.
Thank you, Councillor. Right of reply. Okay, thank you. If there's no more discussion, I'd like to put that motion. All those in favour? Against? Carried. Councillor Henningsen, I can't see you, whether you're voting with us or not. Thank you. Now, Councillor Braun.
Yes, thank you, Madam Mayor. Can everybody hear me okay? Fantastic. Okay. I would like to speak to US OB2. I'd like to move as is on the board now. If somebody would like to second that, I'm not changing it.
I can second it.
Thank you. So this is a fairly small thing, but I think it's an important thing. We've been talking about tree coverage in the city of Salisbury. So I've asked for 10 Moreton Bay fig trees to be planted at the St Kilda playground. The reason I've specifically asked for Moreton Bay fig trees is because I've had lengthy discussions with Perry Coleman, who's an environmental scientist and also a local Salisbury resident and very familiar with the area, and has recommended that these are hardy trees that will deal with the salt from the ocean being on the waterfront, but also some of the salt problems that we're also dealing with in St Kilda at the moment, providing they're planted correctly and have the right treatments put in place. They will become very large trees, potentially not in my lifetime, but in my kids' lifetime they will. If you're not familiar with a Moreton Bay fig, these are the trees that are around the botanic gardens that have the really, really big raised root systems that kids play on. So these would be fantastic trees to have around the playground. They'll offer some substantial canopy cover for that area where there currently really isn't any substantial cover. And it'll be something, you know, a legacy to the Salisbury Council going on, that if we plant them now, then, you know, future generations can enjoy them. So hopefully everybody supports this motion. Thank you.
Councillor Buchanan, then Chair Councillor Henningsen.
Sorry, yeah, just very briefly. Obviously, I was more than happy to second this and echo everything Councillor Braun has just said. Madam Mayor, Councillor Braun and Grenfell and myself, about 2 to 3 months ago, had a very good meeting with Perry Coleman and a tour of the boardwalk. In context of looking at the issue with the mangroves, and Councillor Braun has hit the nail on the head in terms of, I guess, noting it's not native to the area, that you know, there is a reason behind this, and I can't stress to the general manager, who I assume is zooming in, that his staff do actually do what's requested in this motion and liaise with Perry, because Perry does have, as mentioned by the mover, Councillor Braun, not only does Perry know the ideal conditions, but there is a number of key locations throughout the park in terms of where it can be done that will also provide shade and wind blocks and things like that. So, look, I think it's a very good motion. I'd like to see this happen sooner than later, because as Councillor Braun mentioned, it does take some years for these trees to grow. And it would be nice for us to be able to go along there and perhaps enjoy them, you know, while we're still here.
Thank you. Councillor Henningsen.
Yeah, I just wanted to support the motion. I was, when we had the other committee meeting, Councillor Braun, I was under the impression that we were finding out if the trees are possible, but now you're saying you've actually already spoken to Perry Coleman and she says that it is. We don't have to do any sort of, you know, soil treatment analysis that might cost us money, or, you know, would we'd be satisfied just with her feedback?
I'll answer that. So I had spoken to Perry previously, which I did raise at last week's meeting, but as point one says, is that we're asking staff to advise of the costs and timeframe to plant the trees. So if you know that that is what we're asking for. I'm only asking for 10 trees though, and I would envisage that 10 trees is not going to be costing us hundreds of thousands of dollars. Therefore, once we've got the costs, I would hope that council would support the planting of the trees. There's only 10 of them.
Councillor, I actually
got it.
Ask for right to speak again, but I thought I'd let you get a quick one in. So if that's all you're saying, that's fine.
I was just answering the question. Thank you.
Councillor Jensen.
Thank you, Madam Mayor. I'm happy to support this motion. It's all it is it's asking for costings and it's asking for a time frame, and we're getting the right consultation from a professional. I've got no issues with it. I've done a bit of biological environmental science myself. Can't say I'm an expert, but I know Perry is, and I think it's probably the best person to speak to. I'd just like to flag the members that weren't at the meeting when we had urban services. Someone actually, I can't remember who it was, but tried to actually move an amendment to make it widespread across the city of Salisbury. Now, that would have been costly. That would have been very dangerous, and a dangerous path to tread down. And what we've got here is actually just 10 trees in a localised environment that have been advised to be the ideal environment for these bulk bay fix. So I think what we've got before us is a great motion. It makes sense, and I'm happy to support it. Thank you.
Thank you. Are there any other speakers? Right of reply.
Thank you, Madam Mayor, and thank you for the councillors that have spoken to this. As I said, 10 trees is it's a small area. If this could be used as a test case for the wider city of Salisbury, fantastic, great. But as the ward councillor for St Kilda, and also being passionate about trees and the environment, I would really like to see this go ahead. And once we get the costings, then hopefully move forward and actually plant the trees. As Councillor Buchanan said, the sooner we plant them, the sooner they'll grow, and we'll see the benefits for it.
Thank you, Councillor. I'd like to now put that, all those in favour. Gates carried. We're now moving on to 5.5. Councillor Duncan is the chair. I'd ask for withdrawal from 5.12.
5.18.
Hang on, 5.1 to 5.17. Councillor, what did you want?
5.8.
5.22. 5.8. Yeah, got it. Are there any other?
5.22.
5.22. Would someone like to move the remainder? Councillor Hood and Councillor Brooke. 5.18. All in favour? Against carried. 5.18.
Yes, Madam Mayor, I'd like to move, if members refer to page 8 on the information item, there was a bit of discussion, so I'd like to move one being what we noted, and 2 and 3. So essentially, that we do, that the council does support the request to host reception for the lines, and that 3, that a non-discretionary first quarter 21 bid be authorised for up to 7,000 to contribute to that meeting. Event, and if I get a seconder,
Councillor Woodman.
I'd like to declare a perceived conflict of interest on the basis that I'm a member of the Lions Club, and a parallel Lions Club for that matter, and that I'll manage that by remaining in the meeting and voting in the best interest of the community.
Thank you, Councillor Brooke.
I'd like to declare an actual conflict of interest of being a member of the Lions Club of Salisbury and the district that's involved, but also assisting with the convention. I'll be leaving the room.
Office bearer of Salisbury.
Thank you.
Look, Madam Mayor, Councillor, I think, raise a very important point. From the gallery at the meeting last week, and look, I was originally moving to go ahead with this, but it will break down in a bit more of a some detailed information, notwithstanding the fact that it is essentially in costs. But I am glad we've got the further information, Your Worship.
relationship, because it does give me a bit of an insight in terms of what the actual costs are doing business in terms of the hub. And I'll pick that up in another forum at another time and place. But I am surprised the photographer, though, very expensive photographer, $490. Is that Lyons photographer or is that council's photographer?
Anyone answer that? General manager?
Through you, Madam Mayor, that was based on cost estimates from the photographer that we might have used.
Yeah, no, I guess that's where I'm going with that question. So effectively every time we engage a photographer for a City of Salisbury event, it's about $500 a pop. Next time I can use my iPhone, we'll save us time.
Thank you. Is there any more discussion? Councillor Reynolds.
Thanks, Madam Mayor. Yeah, I did ask for more information than I've got, so thanks for that. Question I've got, so we're hosting this event, or you're hosting the event, Madam Mayor?
I believe I am, yes.
Okay, so it's a City of Salisbury event or it's a Lyons event?
Lyons event, as they've asked
me. That you're host, okay. And this information wasn't in the report, but is it costing any of the Lyons people any money to attend this event, or is it purely we're putting it on for them? And don't get me wrong, I have absolutely no problem if we're putting it on for them. I'm just wondering if, because it does talk about our contribution.
So, I believe, and please correct me, I believe that the function we're putting on, but the other use that they're using, I believe that, I don't know what they're charging. Does anyone know?
Through you, Madam Mayor, my understanding on the tickets that have already been circulated, there is a fee that has been requested. I can't actually remember what the figure is. I don't know whether it was intended to offset this or offset other costs associated with the convention.
Okay, my only concern here being is that we're stumping up some considerable money. That's okay, got no problem with that. But if people are paying a fee, they're clear why they're paying the fee. Is it because, you know, it's not because Salisbury's asking to pay the fee, it's because of something else is why they're paying a fee to attend. I understand it's their convention. But do the people attending understand that they're not actually subsidising the City of Salisbury by paying their fee? They are subsidising their own event that we're contributing a fair bit of money to. I don't know the answer.
Through Madam Mayor, I'm not aware of what that substitution is. All I'm aware of is there is a fee being requested on the tickets, and I can't recall what the number was.
Okay, I just don't want people going away thinking they're stumping up money because the City of Salisbury's at back of time.
I was under the impression that the fee was for the function, but not actually the mayor's function. Councillor Griffin, can you enlighten us?
All right,
I just want to ask a question.
Councillor Buchanan, can you enlighten us?
Sorry, that's it. I have no problem with contributing the $7,000 on for the event, for the Lyons, don't get me wrong. I just want to make sure that, you know, anyone attending who's paying a fee is understanding why they're actually paying the fee.
I absolutely agree with you, Councillor Reynolds.
All right, thank you.
Is there any more discussion? Councillor Grenfell.
Thank you, Madam Mayor. In the breakdown of costs, I don't see a cost for actual room hire.
Pardon?
Where are we hosting it? Here?
Yeah.
So where's the room hire? Because I've got catering, beverages, cleaning, security, staff provision, welcome to country, photographer, license, liquor license.
No community group, they usually get room.
Is it free or is it?
General manager would like to respond.
Basically the report, it's not actually in this further information, but he said there was also something which included the hire of the room. Not being itemised in there.
Is there any more discussion?
Point of order, Madam Mayor.
Yes, what is your point of order?
Hi, sorry, I don't think that people online could hear what Charles just said. Could you repeat that, please?
That's not a point of order, but I'm happy to ask Councillor.
Through you, Madam Mayor. And it's not detailed in the report that's in the further information, but the actual report that went to the committee flagged that there is also some in-kind support provided by council, and one of those was including the hire of the room.
That's not included in the
Okay. Are we all comfortable? Are you comfortable with that, Councillor Henningsen? Got that?
Yes, I did get that, and I think there's still some other us that wanted to speak, obviously.
Madam Mayor, my hand's been forcibly lowered, but I would like to ask some questions.
Yes, you may, but I think Councillor Buchanan ask questions. Councillor.
Yeah, Mayor, just before perhaps we go on further too much away, given that you're of the understanding that it's a feral perception type thing.
I don't mind if it's not.
No, well, I do. Should be. And that is, I'd like to also potentially vary my motion to ensure that elected members are obviously
absolutely
invited to the formalities.
I think that's very important. Mayoral function, so therefore the council should normally be.
I don't know where you think it's appropriate. I don't really want to attach it to the $7,000, but
mayoral functions don't happen without councillors being.
No. I'm just thinking, you know, the city of Salisbury is providing $7,000. It only.
Councillors and mayor should be of court. Any council function, councils that are using council money should be invited. No question.
Not necessarily that, more the fact that they're using this building, and this is outside of the entire program. This is a gift of $7,000 out of a non-discretionary bid, which is completely outside of our normal.
Good point, Councillor. Thank you. Councillor Blackmore, did you want to ask some questions?
Yes, Madam Mayor. So I'm reading through the further information report, and I guess this has somewhat been addressed beforehand, but I would have thought that this further information report would have had a total cost for the whole event. So do we have a total cost, or what's envisaged to be the total cost of this event?
General Manager.
Through you, Madam Mayor. The only real additional cost that's not flagged is related to that question around room height. Any other little cost that I can think of that will be incorporated, City of Salisbury will be bearing and running this event.
Okay, as an extension to that, I think I'm becoming increasingly more uncomfortable supporting this. And the reason that I'm saying that is because, to me, given that we've got people who are paying for a ticket to attend this, and let's say that, you know, the ticket for these sort of events might be, you know, $50 or so, then that might go up to, say, 50 times 100. We've got, you know, $5,000. So that's, and I'm just making an estimation. I'm not sure how much the tickets are going to be, because, again, that's something we don't have the information on. And, you know, in that case, then really what it's like is council giving a donation to Lions for approximately $5,000 or so. And like, I get the idea of showing them that we have a fantastic resource, which is the Salisbury Community Hub, as a bookable space. But firstly, realistically, it's unlikely that a lot of these people who are traveling a long way are going to be using our hub. And if they do, they might be using it for Lions, which is why they're here. So I think that I'm feeling a little unsure about whether we really had this sort of budget line for this reason at all. And on top of that, I'm wondering whether this sets a precedent for other kind of conventions. Are we going to have a convention budget line? If so, that's something that we agree, but I would like to see it to be open more than just to Lions. You know, we have fantastic service clubs beyond Lions. Not saying Lions isn't fantastic, but other ones that do have conferences and would be willing to take $7,000 towards their conference. We actually have service clubs that spend a lot of money fundraising to make sure they don't have to ask for funding from, you know, local councils and that sort of thing. So at this current stage, unless I get more information about, let's say, you know, the full ticket cost, the full event cost, and if it is just hiring, it's actually not all that much just for one evening. So, yeah, not really comfortable with this. And elected members, you can have your own opinion, but I'm not convinced.
Yeah, and Councillor, can I tell you that we have always welcomed any club, especially volunteers, into the council and had functions for them over the last 30 years. But I have to say that I believe the tickets are for the conference, not for the function.
Now, I'm sure we can find out more about that, but that's my belief. Councillor Buchanan.
Yeah, Madam Mayor, it's actually free.
So, hang on. So, just so I understand, are they saying that there's a convention, they'll be paying for the convention, and there's going to be a reception the evening before? They envision that the reception will cost $7,000 for that one evening, and it then flows through to the convention. Is that correct?
Madam Mayor.
Councillor Buchanan, do you know anything more?
Other than what's in the report, which that was presented to Urban Services, that was presented to the Community Wellbeing Committee, the General Manager might shed some light, but essentially the way I understand it, Mayor, is that there is a, certainly there's the annual convention, which is a very big thing in the Lions. And the City of Salisbury is, very lucky to be able to have the opportunity to have the district convention held here, because the Lions District of 201C1 is a very large district comprising of many Lions clubs. This is the reception aspect, of my understanding, of that convention. So these costs, my understanding, with all the units, are being provided not by Lions, but by the City of Salisbury. So these are costs that have been put to Lions and to the committee by, you can say, the administration, in terms of having this event held at the hub. They're not the event, the reception for the convention held at this hub. So Councillor Reynolds rightly asked for some additional information in terms of the costs and how they come about, etc., etc. That's been provided, Your Worship, on page 81 of the further information report, and that's how the staff come up with the costs. In terms of will Lions be making money out of this, my understanding, absolutely no. It's the reception is ticketed in the sense that because of COVID capacity, there's 135 tickets. They won't be charged. And more importantly, Madam Mayor, if they would like to have the receipt of $7,000 from the City of Salisbury, I would like to seek a formal variation. That's all I did. That out of that 135, members of this council wish to attend that reception, that they obviously have an invitation extended to them. We won't be rude and say partners and everyone else, but certainly, as a matter of courtesy, that the elected members of the council be invited to that reception. That's essentially, not essentially, that will be paid for and staged by the City of Salisbury as per the recommendation from staff and the
thank you, Councillor.
Maybe seek advice. I'm not sure where we put the bit about elected members, we can maybe attach it to part three or whether that's part four, I don't know.
Are you waiting for me to speak?
Councillor Henningsen, yes.
Oh, sorry. Look, I'm with Maria on this one for all the reasons that Maria outlined, but I'd also like to highlight some other issues. There seems to be an ongoing practice of more money being spent outside of when we've set and locked down the budget. And there's a lot of members that are very proud about their budget and want to espouse it. But I think there needs to be a balance between, giving people what they want and finding some holistic sort of solution that makes it fair and reasonable. Giving this money to the Salisbury Lions, in my mind as well, and perhaps I could be corrected if I'm mistaken through the administration, but I would have thought that this should have gone through a community grants program and gone through the proper process like every other community group does, and within the budget, within those particular grants. The other thing is, I would like to know if the Salisbury Lions have already had funding in recent years through grant funding. Because if they had, they might not be eligible for this funding in this round, because it might not be the 5-year or 2-year period, whatever it is. And this is sort of a bit of a workaround, if you like, to overcome that sort of issue. So, if council could answer those questions, but I would suggest that given that this event isn't until October, that we defer it until we get the additional information and we have another chance to have a look at it. I'm not sure whether I have to move a motion to defer because I've already spoken. Sorry, I'm not really good on the meeting rules 100% yet. But again, that's my feedback. And if I could have some answers on grant funding, that would be good.
Councillor, I'm now going to ask Councillor Buchanan your right of reply. Councillor Buchanan,
Mayor, I'm more than happy to address, I guess, some of the...
Can I make a point to you, yes, and I hope you will include it? You have been around for a long time. We have always celebrated our volunteers.
I'm going there, Mayor.
Celebrated our football club.
Yes, yes,
wins.
Yes.
So if you would add that to your right of reply, I'll be great.
Thank you for that great prompt. Your Worship, as I was rightly going to point out, and in response to, I guess, some of the very reasonable and legitimate questions asked by members of this council in regards to why we're funding this and how we're funding it, what you're seeing happen before us at the moment is actually best practice. You know, you're seeing a group that is one of the oldest, with the exception of Rotary, one of the oldest and the largest service clubs in the world, that has these events that do come up every now and then. We've assisted service clubs over many years when we have these kinds of big events. There is no way that we can have this fall within the community grants process in terms of the criteria and the timeframes. So what's happened is the committee's rightly received the report and has gone through that correct process, it's had the information. And because it's outside of the community grants guidelines, and it's got nothing to do, quite frankly, with the community grants, this is a request for funding. The terms of reference that we have set up for the Community Wellbeing and Sports Committee enable, you know, that committee to consider these types of things. Normally, I would say it would go to Finance and Corporate Services Committee, but for whatever reason, we've put it through this committee. And what's happening now is that it is literally just being put to council for consideration for a non-discretionary bid. Now, it's going through that process. We required further information. Councillor Reynolds got that further information tonight, and here we are making that decision. Whether members want to support or not, it's entirely up to them. The reality is, this is a major convention that is being held for Lions, hosted within the city of Salisbury. Will we do the same thing if Rotary approached us? Yes. Have we done this thing for sporting associations when they've come to us in the past? Absolutely. Mind you, in the last few years, Your Worship, probably the last 4 or 5 years, we haven't done many mayoral receptions. But as the mayor would know, going back 10 years ago or so, we used to do regular mayoral receptions and highlight sporting or community achievements and things like that. Obviously, budget, you know, things are a bit tough. So, you know, this group has gone through the proper process. Council's going through the proper process. We have a budget. This falls outside of the budget. Reason why it has to be done now, because we've asked that going to the first quarter review, and that needs to be done beforehand. So as a non-discretionary bid. So, you know, if we were to wait and have further information and deferrals and things like that, you know, there's every chance that we would miss the boat, and let's just get on with it. So an event of this scale can actually be planned and accommodated. Yes, I'm interested to know whether the group may or may not get other funding opportunities and source grants and things like that. But guess what? With all due respect, that's not really about business, if you know what I mean. I know plenty of organisations, and when they're hosting events and things like that, they'll, you know, look at what happens at a convention centre, for example. They'll go to the state government for sponsorship. They'll go to every Tom, Dick and Harry for sponsorship. The sponsors don't all ask each other, what are you getting from them so I can determine how much am I going to give you? It just doesn't work like that. You know, the City of Salisbury is doing its bit. The mayor's hosting this reception. It's essentially a City of Salisbury hosted event for the Lions Club of South Australia. Yes, the Lions Club of Salisbury would certainly, you know, this is a Lions thing here, will put their banner up and claim that, you know, it's a hosted by them. Good on them. They're the ones that got in first. Would I have, you know, offered the same thing through Parallel Lions if our club asked? Well, obviously. But the reality is Salisbury Lions Club have asked to hold it through the way our structure works within Lions, you know, the district reception here. They've obviously had to have agreed to that for this application even to come before us. But what is important, Your Worship, is that the elected body, if they would like the opportunity to attend, that they can attend.
In that case, I'd like to put that all those... No, that's a right of reply. Nothing's come now except a vote. I'm sorry. All those in favour? Against? Harry. Moving on to Councillor Reading.
I'll get Councillor Brook.
Oh, sorry. Yes, please.
Waiting for somebody.
The extensions,
yeah. Oh.
Thank you, Councillor.
Yeah, thank you, Madam Mayor. I rise to support and move this motion. I was one who actually moved the motion initially. I'm happy to move the recommendations on the report. I would like to just state that the whole reason behind this was to encourage and support some of our volunteer organisations. So I think with point three, I hope staff don't go overboard and develop a 10-page guideline and a 20-page application form. Just briefly, page 75, the executive summary goes into it a little bit deeper. I just have two questions, if I may. It's got volunteer involving organisations. I've never heard of that before. Is that something the staff have developed or created? And I was just wondering why it's called, if it is volunteer involving organisations, why is it VOI and not VIO?
General Manager, have you got an answer for that?
I'll try and answer. The reference to volunteer involving organisations, that's a term that's used within the group that looks after volunteers. Whether it's the right abbreviation, I can't answer that, whether it's correct.
I just wonder whether it's a typo or not.
Yeah, I suspect it is, Councillor.
The second thing I wanted to query was the next paragraph, which says that the VIIs events are only limited to three per month. Is that from the one organisation or is that in total?
General Manager.
The intent is, I think as a report, if you had read it, it was sort of included, there was about 100 sort of events in 1 month. So trying to make sure there's a balance. So not from one organisation, it could be a mixture of, but it's trying to balance, the number of groups that we might promote through our digital infrastructure.
I'd just be very disappointed if we had four requests and because of the guidelines, we'd knock one back. So I hope that's a bit more flexible than that. But I'm happy to move the recommendation as is.
Can I have a second, please?
I'm happy to second.
Is there any more discussion on this item? Councillor Brook.
Just quickly, a question. I wasn't a part of the discussion earlier, but I understand the digital infrastructure to be defined by big screen and other small screens within the hub itself. And then any other community centres that have the digital infrastructure facilities, is that correct?
I've got an answer for that? Yes. All right. Are there any other, is there any other discussion on this? I'll put that, all those in favour? Against? Now we're moving on to 5.6, innovation and business, and I'd ask for withdrawals from 5.6 to 5.9. Any withdrawals? Would someone like to move it?
Yes, I'd like to withdraw SPDSC3, please.
I'm happy to read. Okay, and moved by Councillor Grenfell, seconded by, have a seconded? Councillor Wood. Thank you, never let me down. Thank you. All those in favour? Thanks, carried. 6.2.
Point of order. Madam Mayor?
Yes?
I put my hand up to withdraw 6.3.
Point of order,
there's no such thing as 6.3.
SP3, yes.
And that's what we've got for you.
That's what we're moving on to.
Oh, sorry. Sorry, it's a little bit hard to hear sometimes.
That which is part of 6.2, but it's SPDSC3. Would you like to talk on that now, Councillor Hennings?
Yeah, I would, thank you. First of all, I'd like to thank the team for a fantastically robust report. I think that, you know, a lot of the issues within the Walkley's corridor or any new development for that matter are always issues that can't necessarily be reconciled. So traffic engineering has limitations, or, on-site parking is, can only be built in a certain way, although there might be a few options.
Harry, what is your point of order?
We're speaking to a motion.
Stand up, please.
Thank you, Madam Mayor. We're speaking to a motion that we don't know what it is and we haven't got a seconder for it. Before we enter discussion on the motion, make sure that we know what the motion is, whether it's moved as is or whether there's going to be an amended form, and whether there's a seconder before we discussion.
Okay, so first of all, are you moving this item?
Yes, I'm moving the item as is.
Seconded.
Yes, I'm moving the item as is and just wanted to congratulate the organisation on a fantastic report. And but I think the only real major concern I have for this project is the number of freestanding single story homes with a bit of a garden, versus the townhouses. I think one of the strongest messages from the community feedback was an issue around, well, they don't want townhouses, they don't want Mawson Lakes, and that's going to create more congestion. I appreciate we get a traffic report back on this, but I would really appreciate if the organisation could consider some alternate housing where there is more freestanding. And I'd like to see what the costing is on that. So if we sold 20 townhouses versus 10 houses and 10 townhouses, you know, are we better off with freestanding versus a mixture or whatever? So, I know that the next phase is about the budget, but that was something that I really wanted to bring everybody's attention to. That's it. So thank you.
General Manager is here to take. I have a seconder, Councillor Wood. Did you want to ask Terry any questions in particular, or are you just generally saying what you prefer?
Yeah, I just wanted to raise the issue about community concern around freestanding, and I'm thinking that not every new development needs to be townhouses. Ingle Farm in that section there, it's prime real estate. You'll get a good money sale of the land as opposed to sort of further out north. It's a very popular place to move, and it might be more financially beneficial for us to consider more houses. I don't probably I don't know. But also it's about responding to the very strong community sentiment about not too many townhouses.
Do you want General Manager to try to answer that, or are you aware that no decisions have been made and we will continue to see reports on this?
Yeah, that's right. I don't need any answers at this stage.
Thank you for that.
Thank you.
Councillor Reynolds.
Thanks, Madam Mayor. Look, I'm happy for this to go through as is. Look, I know Councillor Henderson's comments about townhouses and freestanding and community consultation. Councillor Henderson's been a really big supporter of affordable housing and better options. And look, I wouldn't buy a townhouse, but we all know townhouses and that kind of stuff is cheaper and more affordable than freestanding houses. Okay, the townhouses come with other concerns like traffic and rest, but they aren't going to make people concerned. So when we do these kind of things, we've always got that balancing act between the community's concerns, but also our other objectives we have, which is, and by the way, I'm not saying our other objective here is to make money. I'm not saying that. Our other objective is affordable housing for more people so we get a bigger population in as well. So I appreciate we've got that balancing act that we have to make when these things come forward to us. So I just find it interesting that, you know, we're asking for more freestanding houses potentially, when on the other hand, we're asking for more affordable housing. I'm sorry, but unless you can find a solution where they meet in the centre and they're exactly the same thing, which quite often they're not, I'm not too sure what you want us to do in terms of pulling us one way in terms of going for affordable housing and pull us in the other way saying, but I want freestanding. So I'm trying to reconcile the left and right of arc here of what some people are proposing and have proposed in the past and where they actually want us to be. It's a balancing act, I know, and we've got to appreciate it's a balancing act, but happy for this to go through.
Thank you. Is there any more discussion? Councillor Henningsen, would you like a right of reply?
Yes, please. Look, I wasn't saying, Councillor Reynolds, that we should have no townhouses, but when we look at the current concept plan, there's more townhouses than freestanding. So I'd like just to see what the options are around that. And secondly, I would say that absolutely for affordable housing. If this, but first we need to make a decision. Well, let's just say that all of that was just freestanding houses. We made a decision. We would still have to apportion 15% for affordable housing. So that could be smaller one-bedroom houses or two-bedroom, whatever. I'm not proposing no townhouses, but I think the mix at the moment is a hell of a lot more townhouses than it is, you know, the freestanding. And as we progress, you know, we'll probably get a market report on, you know, interest in the area to buy properties, that sort of thing, and we'll have some more information on that. But yeah, I think that, again, I just really want to be emphasising that we just don't want another Mawson Lakes.
Thank you, Councillor.
As much as I love Mawson Lakes.
Now, let's put that all those in favour. Okay, it's carried. Moving on now to the audit committee, which is 5.7, Councillor Reynolds is chair. I'd ask for withdrawal 7.1 to 7.1.8.
I'm happy to move.
Moved by Councillor Reynolds, seconded by Councillor Hood. All those in favour? Against, carried. Council, just note the assessment panel meeting held on the 29th of June. CEO review committee. Two items 901 to 912. Are there moved by Councillor Proleta, seconded by Councillor Woodman. Is there any discussion? I'll put that. All those in favour? Thanks, carried. There are no general business items. Motions on notice. 7.1. Councillor Reynolds.
Thanks, Madam Mayor. So the motion is as we had before us, but might give Council an opportunity to.
Seconded by Councillor Hood.
No.
Very confident.
Declaring confident.
Madam Mayor, I'd like to declare an actual confident just on the air of the caution side. I'd like to declare an actual conflict of interest, as it involves the football club that I am a board member of. With that, I will leave the room.
Thank you. Councillor Reynolds.
Thanks, Madam Mayor. So the motion we have before us is the administration input from Norfolk Council to prepare a project brief for a precinct plan of council consideration October 2021 regarding Salisbury North oversight, with the objective of preparing a concept plan with indicative high level cost and estimates for possible options of development, prioritisation of necessary works. Brief to also include recommendations for raw resourcing preparation precinct plan. I guess I'll ask for a seconder.
Councillor Braun has seconded.
Sure. So what we're looking at here, it's not looking to spend any money right now. This is about preliminary work and having a look at the whole precinct and what we have there. If you're not aware, Salisbury North and that precinct is more than just a football club. There's a cricket club, there's a netball club with about 10 teams, at least 10 teams involved with it as well. If you're not aware of that precinct, apart from having also the skate park and public toilets at the skate park, there's a couple of playgrounds. There's also actually a gem club there. So there's an old scout hall that is not Salisbury North football club land, it is on council land. It's an old scout hall we have there, a couple of sheds. Used to have the scouts there, then they had racing pigeons there. Now they've got a gem club that are there, but the shed itself is pretty old and probably need a bit of a TLC. So what this is looking at to do is have a look at Salisbury North precinct as a whole, the sporting precinct as a whole, consider female participation because they really only have two change rooms there at the moment that just accommodate the football. There's nothing there for the netballers. There's nothing there really. I was going to say really for the cricketers as well. There's a lot of sheds there that, you know, it would be good to consolidate sheds. There is some council space there as well. This is, again, just looking at a high-level plan, providing a high-level briefing, leading towards, okay, what's the art of the possible later on? What are the needs of the area later on? So the club is growing, especially in terms of female participation, just we don't have the facilities to match it. Similarly, the club's growing in terms of netball and other things. Again, we don't really have the facilities to match it. So that's what this is looking to do, just start with a high-level plan and be guided from there and see where we go. Not actually asking for any money for this at the moment, just produce the high-level plan, see where that takes us from there.
Councillor Duncan.
Thank you. Thank you, Councillor Reynolds. Apologies. I appreciate the intent of your motion. I know North very, very well. In its form at this point in time, for two reasons, I can't support the motion as is, but I would like to recommend to you an amendment. If you'd like, would you rather have the amendment now or go for the briefs?
Sure.
Okay. So we'll go for the amendment first. I'll move an amendment that the motion of notice regarding the Salisbury North Sporting Precinct be noted. Two, that council give in principle support to the precinct plan for Salisbury North Oval. And three, that further consideration of the precinct plan be presented to the relevant standing committees at a date to be determined prior to the 22-23 budget process. And the reason I move that is not because, you know, as you said, it's not about committing money now, but it's committing significant resources. And as chair of these community wellbeing and sports grant, my responsibility as well is to look after our staff as well. And what we've currently got on our books now is we've got Bridgestone delayed again, trying to get opened. In October, we've got a report coming back about a little para golf course and requirements there. We're in a major piece of work with the Salisbury Recreation Precinct. That's looking at a cost blowout there. There's a lot of work going on. And we also have as well, and this covers off on a couple of your points, Councillor Grenfell, and is the reason why. This is why we should wait as well. So one of the things on the books due back is in September is the upgrades to current sporting facilities. Now, in that one, we are looking at that staff provide a report for costings upgrade for current major sporting centres, excluding Inglewood Farm to support a community over the next 40 years. We've also got on our books due in October indoor sporting facilities. A further report be brought back in the Works and Service Committee from completion a fit for purpose audit, patron feedback surveys, and sport infrastructure plan. So we're going through and we're having a look at all these. We're also looking at our place activation strategy. All of these things are due coming towards the end of the year. We're going to be overloading our staff, and that's what I'm worried about. I don't want to come up with a half-assed plan about Salisbury North. I'd rather wait. So all that sort of work is done with. Bring it to our committee.
Half job, you mean?
Half job. bring it to the committee after all the major work's done on those major pieces of work, because I don't want anything to interfere with massive pieces of work. Right? And we don't have a general community development manager right now. We've got Andrew Hamilton, who's absolutely smashed. We need to just put this off a little bit, right? So I understand the intent of wanting to do something, and as I said, absolutely agree in principle of wanting to do a precinct plan for Salisbury North. But this needs to wait till we get through some major pieces of work. Also noting as well that in the last year we've just given Salisbury North 50 grand for a scoreboard. We've done a netball court, we've done some fencing, we just moved forward some money for the immigration irrigation. So they've had a little bit, so I'm sure they'll be fine about waiting a little bit longer. All right. The other factors about not being funded, there's nothing in the long-term plan. It really needs to go to the budget process.
And before you move on, Councillor, we need to get it up on screen. Have you got it written down?
I certainly do. Would you like up to... Okay.
Right. Can I seek to debate that, include that as a variation, Madam Mayor? Still satisfies the intent I'm looking for.
You're happy with the variation?
Oh, I'm ecstatic with that variation.
Oh, good. Councillor Broad, are you happy with that variation? Yes. She's saying she's nodding yes, so that's fine.
Okay, so we've got that, and Governor's happy with that being a variation, which makes it... Yep. As I advise that maybe that amendment was too far away from the original motion, which would have been happy to vary. So that just gives time for our current, all the stuff we've got on the
board. Would you now withdraw your motion, Councillor Reynolds?
No.
You're picking up.
Essentially, I'm speaking to his motion that he's varied. So essentially, it just gives time for our staff to get back settled, get through some major pieces of work that are coming up, and then we can put in before coming up to the next budget process, putting some money into it. So instead of just having a sort of, you know, a half-baked plan, the staff will just have to pump out really quickly because of the amount of work. You know, we should put some money in the budget here and get like a proper consultation, like a proper consultant going and do something really good and do a proper master plan. So
you're happy with that variation? The seconder is happy with that variation.
Sorry, do you actually need part one there that'd be noted? You've got a motion on notice.
And that was the consultation staff.
Well, part two, Madam Mayor, if I understand, was a segue to the previous part, which was about giving in principle support to the...
And by October 21.
Yeah. Council, what was it? Council giving in principle support. Precinct plan or something like
that. Yes, we should be number one on that. What it was given.
Yeah.
Which we do.
Still there.
Yeah, absolutely.
Is everyone reconnected? Oh, I need to get leave from the meeting because he's changed again slightly, and leave from the...
Lisa would have been eight once. He hasn't changed it again.
Well,
check with Lisa.
He's clarified it. Okay. Is everyone comfortable with the clarification?
Only been very once.
Councillor Duncan. Or everyone show of hands that you're comfortable with the not changes. Clarification.
Council,
Thank you. Is there any more discussion?
I have a quick question, Madam Mayor.
Yes.
So looking at the variation again, it says that we give him principal support to the precinct plan, but have we seen a plan? Or is it that we give support to making a plan? I just don't think I've seen a plan.
Understand, yeah, if as sort of over give council give in principle support to developing a Salisbury North.
Okay.
Is that cool with everyone?
Yeah. And everyone's happy with that clarification? And the second is happy with yes, you can.
Yes.
Councillor Woodman.
Thank you, Mayor. And thank you, Councillor Hunton, for pointing out that there are a number of options available to us for sort of sporting clubs and building work over the next year. I just want to say that, you know, I started to feel like I should put in a plan for the Ingle Farm Wellness Centre right now for the fear that it would drop off the agenda. I believe it was supposed to be ready for completion next year. Clearly, this is not happening. I think the motion was put through before the last election that Ingle Farm would be high on the agenda of the Recreation Centre and the Community Centre at Ingle Farm, and I was told that it would be finished by 2022. It's not happening, but I think if we keep throwing in these proposals, for things, I think is it going to be perhaps on the agenda that Natasha and I should get together and plan and draw up the Ingle Farm Wellness Centre, because maybe it will get higher up on the priorities. I'm being polite by sitting back and waiting my turn, and I'm thinking that, you know, it surely will be coming to fruition soon, that we'll be looking at plans for this, but quite frankly, I don't think there's any plans drawn up, and I think we put this through in 2018. So I'm hopeful that perhaps we won't fall off the agenda.
Thank you, Councillor. Councillor Buchanan.
Thanks, Madam Mayor. And look, I was, you know, Councillor Woodman, I can't resist. No, just joking. In all seriousness, Madam Mayor, it's probably completely irrelevant to the motion before us, so we're probably out of order at any stage. But I think the point that Councillor Woodman made with the wellness hub of Ingle Farm, the budget process and everything that Council has already signed off on, and, you know, we've been through this for quite a long time. The Council has, you know, has on numerous occasions received detailed report, budget processes and all sorts of where that's at, and you know, the reality is that the wellness centre is on the radar, but due to budget reasons, you know, that will be put off to, I think, 2024 at the earliest. That is a fact that has now been locked in the budget. That's now part of the ongoing capital works program for this council. But in context of the motion that's before us tonight, Madam Mayor, I do know that you know, this is something that the North Ward councillors have been talking about, you know, for some time. I know Councillor Hood, who for obvious reasons has a conflict of interest and can't participate on this particular motion tonight, is very well aware of, is the fact that there has been a lot of works that have happened in isolation over the years, and particularly the last couple of years at this location. And what does need to be done at some stage, and I agree, it's about prioritising and putting it in the mix for consideration on its own merits and things like that. And I think no one's arguing that we don't have a process by no stretch of the imagination, much like we did with the Wellness Centre and other Ingle Farm Wellness Centres and no doubt other key infrastructure projects. But this does need to be looked at rather than have a piecemeal approach, which has been happening over the time. And think bits and pieces happening in isolation, it does need to give some long-term view in terms of how we bring this whole precinct together. And I'll give you an example of where ultimately this can go, Madam Mayor. And Councillor Braun and myself have been working together, obviously when we develop, you know, master plans and precinct plans and things like that, you know, it is that high-level stuff, and we do that, you know, through the relevant standing committee, and then once we've got a, you know, a master plan in place, you know, then we look at the operational and the practical application side of it. So, you know, we are talking very high level stuff, and some of the stuff that we've been doing in that area with the Livelock Park, as Councillor Brook would be aware of, and Councillor Brown. The Livelock Park Working Party, we've got some key representatives from stakeholders from that area, myself and Councillor Brown on there. And, you know, we did go through this process. It started at this, and Livelock Park started a long time ago. So I think Councillor Reynolds and Councillor Hood should be under no illusion that this is going to be a long process to get to where ultimately they're wanting to go. And I think Councillor Duncan's suggested wording of the 22-23 budget process is actually being very modest and kind, because I do know that if we use the same timeframes we looked at with the Livelock Park side, you know, to put it into context, it's really 24-25. There was a long lead into getting the stuff happening with the Livelock Park stuff. So look, I hope we can follow a similar process and model, you could say, that we've done with the Livelock Park, looking at it as a precinct. We're doing a master plan for the whole Livelock Park area. And I think that's due, Madam Mayor, General Manager, on for Freddie to chip in. I think, well, I should know, I think it's part of my original motion. I think we had to report back to council October or December this year. So, you know, this is a very long process, and Councillor Duncan's right. That's another one Councillor Duncan forgot to throw in the mix. That staff also have to work up the Livelock Park Master Plan, which also has to be reported back in October or December this year. So the list is ever growing. So look, I think it's sensible, and you know, we'll still get there, but this is a much better way of achieving the same direction.
Councillor Henningsen.
Sorry, I'm having trouble lowering my hand. I'm trying to do it and it's just not doing it. So just ignore me for now, sorry. I might just log in and log out actually on it. Is it gone now? Yep, okay, great, thanks.
Councillor Reynolds, go on with
that. Sure, thanks, Madam Mayor, and thanks everyone for their comments. Absolutely appreciate what Councillor Duncan is saying as well. I go back a couple of years ago when we were talking about the Sports and Recs Committee just at the time, it seemed focused on handing out grants. And one of the feedbacks we provided when we did the rehash of the different committees was we said we need that committee to have a bit more of an overview of all the sporting facilities and what's going on. And that's exactly what you've seen tonight, is Councillor Duncan as the chair doing exactly the job that we wanted to be done for that committee, and saying, hey, we need to holistically look at everything we're doing around here in terms of sport and rec for the community. And sorry, we very much appreciate the feedback he provided and the variations he put before us, so that Salisbury North can be there. Now, difference between this Salisbury North and what we have for Ingle Farm is Ingle Farm's already on the books. Motion's already been there. Council's already decided we are going to do it. Timeframe might be different, correct, but Salisbury North is not on the books right now to be considered. So that's what this is looking at to do. It's looking to do that preliminary work. I'm under no illusion as to how long this might take. It took me 3 years to get one netball court at Salisbury North, going through the process and of everything that went through at council, but finally that netball court got there and it's going great guns. I've got no illusion about how long this might take, but it's all got to start somewhere. This is hopefully the start of it. And commend the motion to you. Thank you.
Now, I put the motion. All those in favour? Against? Carried. Seven, two. Councillor
Henningsen. Thank you. I'm going to make this really, really quick, because I've already presented this motion last July. The motion didn't pass. I'm sure you're all very well aware of it. I'm going to keep putting this motion forward every year, until it gets passed, because, I think the community deserves some openness and some transparency. You know, it enables the community to understand better what we're doing and why we're doing it, so that they can understand our decision-making processes. As I had reported last year, I have over 10 metropolitan councils that already do live streaming. And that's an ongoing commitment, whether COVID or not. Obviously, we've got COVID at the moment. But, you know, we really need to be more transparent with our community. We've been elected to represent our community, to stand up, whether we're confident with speaking or not, whether we get the meeting rules correct or not. God knows I don't. But, you know...
Councillor, I have a point of order.
Yes?
I take it, Councillor. Yes? Hanson has started off this. This is obviously part of her 5 minutes, clearly. But she started this off by saying she moved the motion.
I'm sure you did say that you are moving this motion of yours.
Well, I've put the motion on notice, so yes, I would like to move it.
Do I have a seconder for that? I'm sorry, Councillor, there is no seconder.
Okay, thank you.
Moving on now to 7.3. Councillor
Henningsen. Yep, sure. So if you could just move the screen up a little bit, please.
Are you moving this?
I am moving 7.3. I would like to move 7.3. And if I have a seconder, I will speak.
Madam Mayor, I'm happy to suggestion the mover may wish to take, and then second it.
Councillor Henningsen, did you hear that? Councillor Buchanan wanted to make a suggestion, and if you approved of that, he was seconded.
Thanks, Madam Mayor, and I appreciate the intent of what the mover's trying to do here. And look, if the motion did get a second, I was going to propose this amendment, but if the mover wishes to perhaps move it in amended form, as suggestion of having a seconder, that is that staff bring back a report to council no later than October 2021, reviewing the video capability in the chamber and the costings involved to improve the video capability and the ability for elected members to participate.
Give me a second. Councillor Henningsen, can you hear this?
I can, yes.
Can you hear what Councillor Buchanan is suggesting?
Yes, I can. Before I do, I think that, okay.
Councillor Buchanan's already said he'll second it.
No, if the mover's willing.
I've explained that to the mover. So have you finished explaining, Councillor Buchanan?
Given me the opportunity, Your Worship, it's no real different to what the mover's propose, except the key bit is that it's subject to a further report and costings, essentially. So that if a report comes back in October, we look at the costings involved in improving the video capability and also, you know, enhancing the opportunity for elected members to participate.
Are you happy to variate your motion?
Not at this stage, no, and I'll explain why if I can speak.
That's fine, then you do not have a seconder at the moment, so I need a seconder. Councillor Reardon, are you seconding it? You have a seconder, Councillor Reardon. Continue.
Thank you. Look, I had a conversation with the manager of governance, who advised me that the CEO had said that they can take steps to implement this. In fact, you know, the video capability, as you know, the governance manager had already put forward a workshop on the whole council meeting procedures, and I'm just sort of expanding on that in terms of video capability to enable us online to see each other when we speak. At the moment, we only see, you know, the agenda and in a very small window, the corner of the meeting room, and we don't actually see face-to-face people speaking. Apparently, it could already take place and was already, let's do it. I just wanted to formalise this because I just thought that it sort of tied in with the previous moment. So, you know, if the seconder I've got a seconder, it'll just be a question then of whether the rest of the team agrees or not.
Thank you. Have a seconder? Councillor Buchanan. You have a seconder in Councillor Reardon. She has chosen to second it. Councillor Buchanan.
Madam Mayor, I appreciate that our manager of governance, congratulations. I think this is technically your first council, second council meeting, and doing a very good job, mind you, Madam Mayor. Look, you know, I understand, you know, the manager of governance or the CEO may believe that this is just a technical thing that can be, you know, done with a quick thing. The reality is there is cost to this, and there are some changes that will need to be made, no doubt, to ensure that it picks up everything that the intent of what the move is trying to achieve, and also to ensure that, you know, we have the necessary staffing training and the capacity for them to monitor the cameras, move them around and things like that. So there is more work to be done in that regard, and which is why on that basis, Madam Mayor, I did propose to the mover of this motion a simple request about having it subject to a report and some costings done. That hasn't been taken up, so I would like to move an amendment, which is pretty much the same as what.
Before we do that, can we, the manager of governance would like to make a comment, and I'm very aware of Councillor Quigley. Thank you, Quigley.
Through the Mayor, thank you. Indeed, those comments and the undertaking from the CEO were made in context of the returning to the V shape of the chamber, which all members have received email communication about. This was intended to be set up as of August, pending, of course, directions from the Police Commissioner if they were to change. We have liaised with the IT department. We have advised that the current camera capability would be able to accommodate in context of that V-shape, hence the undertaking from the CEO at that point in time to be able to deliver that.
Councillor Buchanan, did you want to finish?
Well, look, you know, it's all very well and good for the CEO to give that undertaking, but the reality is the layout and the design of this chamber is a matter for the elected body, not anyone else to. While there might be some errors in V shape, you know, we are sitting in wards. This ability here gives us the opportunity to sit and have that managed in such a way where, you know, the V shape may not. So I don't want to, you know, support a motion. I notice that will indirectly result in and effectively changing the seating layout where the elected body hasn't you know, had the opportunity to make its decision. By the mayor, but I think to try and achieve what the movers really wanted to try and achieve, I don't see how this could not be done without further consideration on costings there, because what will need to be happened is, you know, are we going to, with all due respect to the manager of governance and the minute taken, you know, there is a lot of time being taken up. We see how meetings get held up while we're waiting for motions to be correctly done, things typed up to be on the board. Is that going to be an extra staff member, or is it an extra function for a staff member to then control the movement of the camera? Have we got any policy guidelines in terms of how the camera and when the camera is going to be shown to people? You know, parliaments in Australia and across the states and other councils, and I'm sure the Adelaide Council being one of them, would have standing orders in terms of how these things function, in terms of how you would have, you know, is the camera only on a member when they're on their feet? Things like that. There's a number of things that need to be considered in terms of this, because it's leaving the process open to interpretation by, with all due respect, you know, unelected, you know, officials in a democratically elected chamber. And on the basis that there is the intent, by looking at the previous motion on notice and a potential motion that's being looked at being considered maybe in other business, of, you know, streaming council meetings, it's even more reason to have this considered in a policy format, especially in a context, especially when we're looking at having the V shape, you know, the flying V, you know, the Salisbury's flying V, you know, the Mighty Ducks, you know, chamber layout.
Thank you, Councillor. The General Manager, the CEO would like to make a comment.
I hear Councillor Buchanan's comments. The design of this room has been signed off by the elected members, and we had a V configuration prior to the introduction of COVID. The only reason we went to this U-shape was 1.5 social distancing. social distancing is now a prerequisite part of COVID assessments, is no longer has the precedence that it did originally. We are now into a general area because of COVID and the Delta variant, that the transmissions are by droplets and air transmissions. So it makes no material difference whether this is a V or a U. The layout of this room is signed off, and the V was consistent to where the wall, the floor plates, and that are aligned to the location of the V, which then enables the installation in an appropriate way of the microphones that the members have previously requested. And so the introduction, reintroduction of the V, which is in line with the original intent of the design and framing and operation of the building prior to COVID, and the location of the cameras were set up with that premise, so you could actually see. And what's being asked in this motion is that the people that actually come in on Zoom or Teams can actually see the whole room and who is talking and what they're is. So that's the point of clarity. That's why there's no additional resourcing required. It's actually the straight setup of the camera and then ability for people who are phoning, dialing in, can actually see their colleagues.
Councillor Proleta.
I think you've just answered it for me, but I was going to ask, because this additional addition to the motion wasn't taken up, so you're going to tell us, by going with this motion on notice, that it is not going to cost any extra finance. Is that correct?
Through you, Chair, that's my understanding, because there already service capability exists, and my understanding, being tested with the existing cameras, that line of sight with that V configuration meets the needs that Councillor Henningsen has flagged.
So it's going to have the video capabilities, and it's not going to cost any extra staff or any extra funding at all to council.
That is the advice I've been given, and that's my understanding, Councillor Pulley.
Okay, thank you.
Councillor Jensen.
Thank you, Madam Mayor. I'm a little bit confused with this motion. It's not very often I do get confused, I am capable of getting confused from time to time. So we're trying to seek the improvement of the video capability for people and rearranging the structure of our council chambers for people that are meeting online and not actually entering the chambers. We've had an email from the manager previously saying that we were going to set up a meeting for it, a briefing session where we could actually discuss it, go through it, work through the bibs and bobs, and actually come up with a practical solution. What we're doing with this motion here is simply saying, oh, there's no real point doing that. We're just going to move a motion. What the heck? Let's just do it. This is kind of a John Wayne principle. I don't see where it's achieving anything quite practical. What we've also got is we've got a situation where what we're trying to do probably doesn't make sense with what the motion actually is addressing. If we had that time where we could sit down, have a discussion, go through the pros and cons, figure out what we could do to make this the best possible chamber it could be, that would be where we'd be able to have those discussions. Right now, what we've got is just a motion that's saying, I reckon this is good, yep, cool, but we haven't had any time to have that discussion or have that informal advice where we can actually sit down and strategise. I would have been quite happy to support the amended form. This form, I'm finding it a little bit difficult to get on board with. Thank you.
Are there any other questions?
Yes, Madam Mayor. This is Councillor Blackmore.
From reading the motion, it sounds like Councillor Henningsen would like the camera to capture each speaker. So if I'm currently speaking, so you would like the camera just on me. I don't think our current video capability has that. Our current video capability, if you can see in the bottom right-hand side of the screen, is
small.
The left-hand side of the chamber. I'm guessing the other camera will pick up the right-hand side, but it doesn't clearly show the speaker. I've noticed when I'm chairing, it doesn't actually show me, it shows half a chamber. So my, I'm gathering from the intention of the motion that Councillor Henningsen would actually like the video on the speaker directly and clearly. So is that your intent with this motion? Just a clarification.
Yes, it is. You know, like when you have a Zoom meeting, either you see, like we do, everyone's faces online and they could be live, you know, just a picture or live, or as the meeting moves around from person to person, like in any other corporate organisation, you just see who's speaking at the time. This isn't... Yeah.
So with that, we'll actually need better video capabilities, which means that we will need better, more systems in place, which means that we would need a report on how much that would cost us, because currently I'm counting two, possibly three, I don't know, I haven't figured out that one's a camera. Or we're all on our laptops or iPads and actually on Teams at the same time, which I don't think will personally work either, because
I like the socially distance. So
it doesn't, I've seen it in chambers, I've seen live streamings where that has happened, where the councillors have actually had it in their, been on their laptops or computers and been in chambers, and it just, there's echo, they haven't sorted that out properly. So as this motion stands, I can't support it. I could possibly support the amended motion.
Councillor Reynolds.
Thanks, Madam Mayor. A little bit confused. I hear what Councillor Reynolds was saying. A little bit confused because Councillor Henningsen said in her opening remarks to this motion that it's already happening anyway.
Well, not, yeah.
He said it's already happening anyway. Councillor Henningsen, found out,
I'm sorry, you have to wait for your right of reply. You can't answer.
What I've since found out, and as per the council notes, it's actually not happening. Because what I've heard is it's for the V configuration. Yep, we know all about it. It's okay. We're not in the V configuration. In this configuration, things need to happen for to have the video capable for this configuration. So, and that's why there will be a cost associated with it. So I like the variation. We're actually asked for what's the cost of it as well. So, you know, I kind of went, if it's already happening and you raise a motion, you actually run the risk of, if the motion gets voted down, that the very thing that you said is happening, suddenly comes to a grinding halt, because the council said it goes to a halt. You always run that risk as well. But I'm not happy to support what we have right now. I support the absolute intent, but I think we're going to be in this situation. We're not going to return to the V, I don't think, for the foreseeable future. Right, we've been living with this configuration now, and I have no real problem with this configuration. But I think it's high time we actually match the AV, the video capability, to match this configuration as well. But to do that, I would absolutely like to know what the costs are for doing that as well, because, again, quoting someone earlier, we can't just, you know, put all these bids ad hoc up out of the process and, you know, out of the review process once we've set the budget. So part of that is being informed as to how much it might cost before we say, yeah, let's move forward with it. Now, I don't think it's going to cost much, but that said, we still probably need the information as well. So right now, I'm not supporting the motion we have before us, simply because it basically does the just do it. Almost gives a blank checkbook approach to it. Now, that might have been based on the assumption that it was already happening. If so, I kind of wonder about that approach as well. But absolutely, I think we actually probably need to just know what the costs are, because from what I've heard tonight, it is not happening as we might have thought it was. We do still need to have costings or some form of work done to work out exactly what we need to get in this configuration, which, by the way, I think we should do anyway, because I think we're going to be sitting in this configuration for probably the next 2, 3, 4 years anyway. So I think it'll be worth knowing. I think we just need to do the work, get the costings, see how we go from there. And because of that, I actually can't support what we have before us, because it doesn't ask for any costings. It just says do it. Thank you.
Is there any other speakers? Councillor Woodman.
Yes, Madam Mayor, I've had my hand up for a while online.
I'll wait for Maria. I know she's before me.
Thank you. So I wanted to address a couple of the concerns, and I agree with many of them. I think that even though we do have that training coming up with the manager of governance, it's a little bit more than just teaching us how to use technology, and a little bit more than just teaching staff how to use the technology, because I assume that we don't actually have the capability to achieve what it is that is the minimum expectation with this motion. So, for example, I actually think that the minimum expectation is a little bit more than what is listed here. So with that, I highly and highly recommend to Councillor Henningsen that she, you know, turn this into seeking a report so that we can have a deeper discussion about this. Because, for example, I think a minimum is that the motion should always be on the screen for someone who's online. And I know, I'm not sure if you're having internet issues or something at the moment, but it disappeared for a little while. So a few other things, like while the CEO said that, you know, we could potentially go back to that V configuration and, you know, even go back to our microphones, I think that that video capability also includes the use of audio. And I don't know if you guys remember the last time we tried to use those microphones when all the golf people came in, but it was awful. So I think that there's actually a lot more we need to improve about our ability to, you know, share online as well. On top of that, while we can potentially, you know, meet COVID guidelines by going back to the V, I think it would actually go against public expectation, because they're going to be, let's say, you know, expecting us to be here at council following the best practice. And, you know, the best practice is not really to be sitting alongside anyone. And that's what the V configuration would make us do. So along the lines of what Councillor Reynolds said is that, you know, it's beyond just training. It's also software and hardware changes that would probably have a cost. If it doesn't, and we can do it already, great, but I haven't seen any proof that we can. And even though we've had quite a few meetings online, I haven't really seen the ability to clearly really see anyone who's there in chamber there. I also think that it's important that we do have that speaker clearly visible when you're in chamber, like we would if we're there, because it's not just the words that are spoken, but also the body language that comes along with it, that we can see when, you know, you can see me on my webcam, but we kind of miss out when I can see all the way from John Harry all the way over to Julie Woodman in about an inch square at the moment. So maybe Teams isn't the way to go, but I think this calls for a report, and I hope that Councillor Henningsen heed that information, because it seems that that's kind of the sticking point for many of us councillors with this motion. And, you know, if this actually fails, it could be basically that council do not support improving our video capability, which we clearly do. We're in furious agreement. We're just not sure exactly whether this motion is what we want. Thank you.
Councillor Woodman.
Oh, Councillor Blackmore, you've said probably what I was going to say anyway. So my feeling is that looking at the room in V shape, we're not going to see who's speaking anyway. It's very difficult to see that unless we had it linked into a microphone that showed the person's, you know, could zoom in on the person who started speaking. And I can't see that happening anytime soon with what the technology we've got. Please all look at that square at the bottom of the screen. It's, you know, you can't. I can't even tell I'm there speaking. I think for the time being, a V shape, which puts us all closer together, you're still going to have a camera heading down both sides, and then what happens to the people at the head table? You have a camera that way. I'm not quite sure how you get three cameras at the same time. I mean, bomb me down, I know, but I mean, I think there is a little bit involved in it, because when they are sitting at home and the mayor is speaking and I'm speaking, and they're going to say, well, who's... They're not going to see both of us if we have a V-shape. And do we put all of you in the V-shape? All the administrators? We have three on one side and three on the other. And we just have these two big long rows that go down the... It's, I don't know. I think we still won't see anyone. So I think we've got a lot of work to do to get us to a situation where we're all on the screen.
Councillor Henningsen, right of reply.
Of elected member colleague teamwork, collaboration is what I'm thinking of. I'm happy to amend the motion with if the seconder is happy to agree, which it just simply
there's a point of order being called. I need to listen to it.
Madam Mayor, that offer was made on numerous occasions very early on in the debate. Everybody has spoken. I believe it's not good meeting practice that after everybody has spoken and they're about to have the right of reply, the chair
can't do it in right of reply.
Sorry. I've been sitting back here waiting for my right of reply, at that, you know, not interjecting and waiting for other people to speak.
Point of order. On the point of order.
Excuse me,
there,
stand
have.
Up, please, Councillor Jensen. What is your point of order?
My point of order is that Councillor Buchanan's clearly called a point of order, and what's happened is he's been interjected upon, and it would be great if we could allow Councillor Buchanan to pursue his point of order.
Councillor Buchanan, is there anything else you want to say, or is that your point of order?
Look, I was interrupted, but I'm sure that the Mayor understands the point that I'm making in terms of the state of the debate we're in. And look, if this motion doesn't pass, I'm happy to propose a similar motion in other business.
Did you hear that, Councillor Henningsen? I'm sorry that you cannot change your motion in the right of reply. It's not possible.
I thought I had to wait until everyone else had spoken before I get to reply again. You know, there's inconsistencies here. I have other people reply all the time.
I'm sorry.
Anyway.
What order, Madam Mayor, just to make it easier for the mover and particularly the administration who may advise you.
Councillor, you're speaking. Oh, this is another point of view.
No, well, it's the regulation clearly states that a variation can be made. But as the lawyers have advised us on many of occasion when we do our meeting practices, is that good, proper meeting procedure is a variation shouldn't be considered after every single person has already debated. Because for the fact is, we're in a full council meeting, and if a variation is introduced at this end of the debate, nobody else has the opportunity to then talk on that variation and may wish to contribute to the debate.
Absolutely.
So the offer was made, technically, Madam Mayor, you can accept a variation. I'm
not prepared to accept a variation in a right of reply.
There's nothing stopping you from doing that under the regulations. But as we've been advised previously, and the practice I've always done as a chairman, is that, if we've gone through halfway through the debate, I always look in my head, pull it up, the council's already debated, chipped into the debate. Well, yeah, we're pushing a little bit whether we accept a variation. But after when everyone else has spoken, and we're just about to do the right of reply, and then to do
it. As far as I'm considering, and I'm chairing this meeting, you cannot change it at this stage in the game. Councillor.
Yes. Can I speak to my motion, even though I can't change it? I'm sure I can.
Right of reply. You cannot change your motion after listening to everyone and then replying.
Yes, but I can reply, correct?
Absolutely, you can reply.
Yeah. Look, my apologies for not getting this right all the time, but I would rather be the kind of counsellor that has a go, and I'm learning along the way. So I appreciate the feedback, and I think the other concern here on, people wanting to make points of order, just to for the sake of it, just bear in mind that with the online
formal motion, and I will take this, Councillor Henningsen, as long as it's not a discussion or a point of order. What is your point of order?
Quite frankly, it's we're going to write a reply. It all has to be about the demotion before us, not the emotion.
And I was speaking
purely about the motion before us.
That's right. You can only discuss what the motion is before us, and the right. You can't have a right of reply to point of order. So,
if you
right of reply to the motion,
to my own motion. I just wanted to say that sometimes there is a little bit of delay in this online thing, which makes it a little bit more difficult for meetings. But I would also remind Councillor Jensen that the upcoming informal strategy, as I understood it, was specifically for the meeting procedures. This is sort of not within that, but,
I must ask you not to make personal discussions with people. You may repeat the motion, the right of reply to the comments made during the motion.
That's right. So Councillor Jensen called me on a point of order or made a comment about the, you know, the upcoming informal strategy meeting was going to discuss this sort of thing. Now, my understanding was that it was not. The informal strategy was purely around meeting procedures and you know, processes. So maybe there was a bit of confusion there. Secondly, video capability in a V shape, like the CEO already explained, whatever shape it is, it doesn't matter. You just need to set your technology up to allow to be able to see each person as they speak. The advice I was given was that this could happen no problem at all. Now, I didn't need to put it as a formal motion. Other conversations had taken place and the CEO was to look into it and make it happen. So I just wanted to formalise it because, like I said before, it spoke to the previous motion. So that's it. I've said all I need to say.
Thank you. I'd now like to put the motion. All those in favour of the motion, can I have a motion? No, Councillor Buchanan, are you in favour? All those against? I'm sorry, the motion has been lost. And I have to
I'll call a division, please. I'd like to call a division.
Oh, a division has been called. All those who voted against the motion, could you please stand?
Oh, can we do it in favour?
Wait, what?
People voting for, none. People voting against, Jensen, Reardon.
Hang on. What? So don't we normally say who's voting for it?
Which way you voted.
Madam Mayor, can you make it very clear about what we're doing here?
All those in favour. Now, we're doing a division, right? Are all those in favour, right? Against? All those against?
No. Madam Mayor, no. You still haven't made it clear. You need
no,
to
No, I know that, but what are you saying is that you're in favour, so therefore you're standing up, so we're calling your names for a division. Is that right?
Yes.
Right. So all those in favour, I will name you. Councillor Blackmore, Councillor Henningsen, Councillor Ook and Councillor Braun. All those against, Peter Jensen, Councillor Reardon, Councillor Prolida, Councillor Buchanan, Councillor Reynolds, Councillor Hood, Councillor Bribe, Councillor Woodman, and Councillor Grenfell. The division, the motion division is lost. Now we are having a break. We're going back, take your seat, we're going back into the council meeting. And the items are the Mayor's diary. Would someone move that? Moved by Councillor Grenfell, second by Councillor Prolida. All those in favour? Against? Elected members' representation activities. Would anyone like to tell us what they've been doing as representatives of the council?
Not all good, Nima.
No? No reports?
Yes.
Questions without notice.
Sorry, point of order.
Yes, Councillor, what is your point of order?
Just that I put my hand up to list down some activities.
I'm not sure it's a point of order, but by all means, if you wanted to tell us what you've been doing, I apologise, I forgot to look over there and see you. You're very small.
Very tiny.
I did send an email with the list of my activities to Rudy and Karen Boyd. She'd asked for them today. So has the administration got a copy of that?
Karen's the only one that can answer this one. You haven't got it? Karen is telling us that she hasn't got it, Natasha. Councillor Henningsen.
Okay, well then let me read them out to you.
Would you like to tell us what you've been doing? Because we don't have it.
Yes, I would. I just need to open the email. Sorry. One second.
Go ahead.
Sorry, I can't open my email. Oh, here we are. Okay, 2nd of July.
Yes.
Res- resident visit at Valley View. Oh my goodness. Can you hear me? 15th of July, councillor, a coffee with a councillor. And then 15th of July, Northridge Scouts Working Bee. Are you there still?
Yeah, we're here.
Okay, are you going to write them on the board? I've given you a couple. Hang on, let me just put them in the Zoom meeting. And you can add them later just to save some time. There we go. Did you get that? Can you see that? Sorry, I think I've put it twice.
Councillor Henningsen, we've got the three. Can you maybe send those remaining ones through and we can include them in the minutes?
I've put them in the Zoom meeting chat.
Yeah. If I may suggest, if you could locate the original email that you sent through Councillor Henningsen and forward it onto Karen, that might be the best way for her to have access to it.
I have tried. I sent it, it went out this afternoon, but it's not going, it's not sending from my outbox. So I don't know what's going on there on my council computer. So they're in the main chat. You've got the three here. Sorry.
Do you have them now on Zoom?
Yes, I do.
Yes.
So they're repeated. There's the 2nd of July, the 15th of July, the 15th of July, and that's it. And then the 26th. Yeah.
Okay, thank you so much for that. Are there any other reports from the councillors representing the City of Salisbury? No, if not.
Other than Madam Mayor, that's the key bit. This is being abused every month now.
Well, not when I clearly say it's all about representing the City of Salisbury, committees and things that you're on to represent the city. So moving on now to questions without notice.
Yes.
Are there any questions without notice?
Yes. Yes, there are. Thank you. This is to the Department of Infrastructure. When will the yellow lines on Euro Crescent be completed? Can council provide a completion date? Oh. That's
Councillor.
Sorry.
The general manager is on the line. He's not here. So ask John if he heard that.
Through the chair. Can you hear me? Yeah.
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 Yeah, so currently the yellow lines that are adjacent to the traffic calming devices are out for consultation. And then there's the petition going out shortly on Yarra Crescent. And that's so once that's all finished, then we'll analyse the results from that. And then probably 2 weeks or so after that, we'll be able to put the lines in. So we would expect the lines to be in by the latest end of September.
Okay, so when I spoke to Damien Roy at last month's council meeting, I asked him exactly the same question. He said, don't worry, we'll get it done. Now, but first he also said, well, we've got to do community consultation. And I explained to him and I sent a very thorough email showing him that the original petition for the yellow lines on Euro Crescent had every resident on that street address as assigned, you know, had signed the petition. And based on that, Damien Roy said, well, then community consultation is not applicable and that we can proceed straight to the yellow line. So can you just highlight, you know, on what basis would a petition where all the residents that live in the street want a change, mate, require additional community consultation? And that's specifically for the, yeah, it's Yura present. Y-I-R-R-A.
Yes, I'm aware of that, yeah. Councillor. My understanding is that there are not 100% of the residents in agreeing with that. On the original petition, not all residents' addresses were on that petition. So from what I understand, I'll stand corrected on that. I don't believe they're all there. There are some residents who are saying they didn't want the yellow signs, is my understanding. So that consultation is about, that consultation is about to go out, as you're aware, I believe, to confirm that. And that's with the Yerkes and also Sunburnt, which was part of the conversation as well. I'm happy to have a conversation with you, Councillor, after the council meeting. Yes,
we'll take it off. Line, but I wanted to formalise this just to express my frustration at, you know, getting answers at council formally and then nothing happens. So I just wanted to formalise it for that reason. You're saying by the end
now, and I think if you need to have more discussion with the general manager, you can do that. But it is without notice. It's not debating.
No worries. Thank you. And I have another question. Sorry.
Yeah.
Can the community engagement process for Red Hill Road be extended?
I don't know whether anyone can answer that. Right, thank you.
I just wanted to formalise the question in the minutes, so yeah.
So, through the chair, the answer to that is yes. We can extend that to the end of August, if that's the like. There's a minimum requirement we need to meet, but we can extend it a bit longer, particularly because of the certain current circumstances. It would seem reasonable to do that.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. Are there any other questions without notice? Moving on now to questions on notice, there are none. Other business and motions without notice, Councillor Reardon.
Yeah, thank you, Madam Mayor. I'd like to move the motion without notice, and that is staff bring back report on options and costs no later than December on improving video capability in chambers, the purpose of online meeting participation in the intent to make the speaker clearly visible via the video camera. Cross was up. Yeah.
Do I have a seconder?
Yes, Natasha, I'm happy to second that.
It's already been seconded by the Councillor Hall. Is there any discussion on that?
Could we have the motion appear on the screen, please?
You can.
Thank you.
The internet is down again, so it could be a minute.
Madam Mayor, do you want Would you like me to read it out again?
Yes, that would be really helpful. Thank you. Councillor is reading it out, so if you could listen, because you may not get it up on your screen.
Okay, the motion without notice reads, staff bring back report on options and costs no later than December on improving video capability in chambers, the purpose of online meeting participation with the intent to make the speaker clearly visible by the video camera.
And the seconder was Councillor Hood. Councillor Henningsen. No, the seconder is Councillor Hood. Did you want to speak, Councillor Henningsen? Yes, please go ahead.
Thank you.
Would anyone else like to speak?
Yes,
but all those in favour.
Madam Mayor.
Hang on, Councillor.
Maria.
Councillor Blackmore, did you want to speak?
Yes, I just wanted to ask to the administration, should we carry this motion? Could some of the comments that were previously mentioned regarding, for example, like the audio of being able to hear, not just see the speaker, be addressed in that report as well? Or do we have to list every little thing that should be included in the report?
We'll be done.
Okay, and if there's an opportunity for an informal strategy, let's say we've already got one scheduled, if we could have like a 5-minute brainstorm of some of the things that we'd love on our wish list, is there the possibility of maybe doing that at some point?
Yes.
Okay, excellent. Thank you.
Now, I'll put the motion, all those in favour. Against? Motion is carried. Moving on to Councillor Buchanan. Yeah, we'll have to, right, we've got a problem with the internet, it'll have to be manual, so listen carefully.
Thanks, Mayor. I've got a couple of motions. One of them should be popping up any second.
No, internet.
Oh, my bad. Councillor Grenfell has said, may wish to second this one. And there's a report we presented to Council with amendments to the Code of Practice for meetings requiring elected members to attend Council in person unless public health directions by the State Coordinator apply.
Do I have a seconder? Councillor Jones. Councillor Grenfell.
Look, Madam Mayor, you know, I think half of our issues will be addressed in terms of, you know, the audio and the video and all of that if elected members actually attended council meetings. Simple as that. Look, I'm all in favour of people during COVID directions to attend meetings remotely. That goes without saying. The Minister was good enough to suspend the Local Government Act to enable council to amend its Code of Practice to meeting procedures to allow for council to open the door for members to attend and participate in council meetings via Zoom. That was in the context of a lockdown. We are, after Wednesday morning, 12:01 a.m, we will not be in a lockdown. In the whole period since it was brought in, council is defined, elected members are defined as essential. We've all seen the relevant sections made to the directions. We are able to attend meetings in person. A part of me thinks, you know, it's a bit harsh if, you know, you have to work. Well, with all due respect, if it's a choice between working and also attending council meetings, we understand work comes first, but at the same token, elected members also have a important responsibility to their ratepayers and make sure that they're able to attend meetings and fulfil those roles and responsibilities. And sometimes it's a choice that the individual elected member may have to weigh up what that priority is for them and their community. The other issue is, well, I'm sick. I can't come to the meeting. Well, I'm sorry. If you're sick, you're sick. If you are sick and you want to go to work, what happens? You're off work. You don't participate in Zoom meetings. You're on sick leave.
You're on leave. You're not participating. You're not working. The same applies here. If you're sick and can't come to a meeting, that's it. You're sick. You put in an apology. You seek a leave of absence. It's pretty straightforward stuff. Because I believe, Madam Mayor, that the elected, that the people that we represent expect us to come here. They expect us to do the work. And more importantly, we receive an allowance. No, we're not paid, but we receive an allowance. And we're expected to come and participate in meetings. We all know that you have a better opportunity to participate more effectively on behalf of your constituents if you're doing the right, you know, the best thing by them and coming to these meetings and participating. I'm not saying that this policy should be extended to committee meetings. No. I reluctantly accepted that amendment to the meeting practices about 5 or 6 years ago when that opportunity first arose. When that opportunity first presented itself, when councils under the Local Government Act were able to allow people to participate remotely in meetings remotely. It was a very contentious issue for council back then. Members that were present here are aware, and some of them have expressed the same concerns to this day. How do we know whether it's safe? Are they participating while they're driving, for example? Do we know whether confidentiality is being protected and things like that? There's numerous issues with that. I didn't give too much weight to those arguments because I thought it's incumbent on the individual to make that decision and adhere to the requirements. So, but I fully respect those arguments, don't get me wrong. Where I'm coming from is more than the fact that our ratepayers expect us to be here. The only reason why we shouldn't be here is if the police commissioner as a state coordinator has issued a restriction or a direction that says, guess what, this is a hard lockdown. Nobody, not even essential workers, are able to attend and do whatever, you know, their business may be. That's to me pretty simple. You know, that's the only way you shouldn't be here. If you've got work, well, you've got work. If you'll find yourself missing a few council meetings because of work, well, I'm sorry, your ratepayers need to know that what is the ability of their elected representative to actually attend council. If you're always sick and can't come to council meetings, again, same thing. You know, one, it comes a time where one has to question whether they are able to be on council and participate in meetings. I attend council meetings. I, like you, have a busy job, a lot of time, you know, commitments, but I put this first and always make an effort to come here. So all I'm saying, Madam Mayor, I think it's time that, you know, we have trialled it. We've done it for what, how long now? I think 12 months almost, or maybe a little bit less than 12 months. And, you know, I just don't think it's working. And more importantly, I think we can save ourselves a lot of money having to, you know, redo the entire audio and visual thing, et cetera, et cetera, to enable people to sit at home and attend council meetings. We can do it in person. If it's a committee meeting, well, guess what? We can set up the rooms where it's only half a committee, half a room, and I'm sure we can position ourselves to sit somewhere so they can all look at each other on the camera, whatever. But when it comes to formal decision-making in the chamber, we need to make sure that people's elected representatives are here, are accountable and are able to participate in those decisions. So, you know, I was thinking about, you know, proposing the amendments tonight, but I think it's much better by doing it via a report, and the staff can bring back the necessary amendments to the policy for us to consider adopting, whether you like, whether you want to adopt it or not, it's up to you. But to me, the motion is pretty straightforward. It's basically saying you're required to attend council unless there is a directive by the state coordinator that says we can't be here in person. If you're sick, do what you have to do at work and put in an apology. Take sick leave, for example. Be straightforward. You know, we could be also exposing ourselves. If you're on sick leave and you're sick and can't attend, you know, how do we know what kind of position you're in to actually make decisions? You know, things like that. You know, there are reasons why in a workplace there is sick leave. And I'm pretty sure that CEO, member of his staff, was home, working from home and then was sick, they would be expected to take sick leave. They wouldn't be participating in work Zoom meetings and activities. They would be on sick leave. It's pretty straightforward. And same thing should extend to us. So I'll leave it at that.
Thank you. Councillor Grenfell, seconder now would like to speak.
Thank you, Madam Mayor. Thank you, Councillor Buchanan, for moving this. As it says, it's only for full council. It's committees, we understand you can attend via Teams. I've had an issue where I don't feel comfortable in moving confidential things because I am unsure of who could walk into the room, where you're situated, who's in your house with you. Last week, when we went into lockdown, we had to do it. I literally had to lock myself in a room in my home so that, because I had four children plus my husband there, but I knew we were moving confidential items. So I locked myself in a room, made sure that nobody could get in, made sure that it was soundproof so they couldn't hear what was going on. But I can't guarantee that everyone on council did that. Now, full council, this is where we are moving everything that we've moved in committees. So the discussion happens and this is where all the decisions are made. Yes, sick leave is there. We've had Councillor Duncan take leave because he had babies. And that is what leave of absences are for. Apologies for sick leave or if you can't make it or if you're stuck at work, that is fine. But otherwise you should be here unless it is directed that you shouldn't. We're currently all wearing masks because that is a directive. The only person who isn't wearing a mask is the person speaking. Once I finish speaking, my mask will go back on. It's a very common thing that we follow public health orders. I can say, as an elected member, I have attended every single meeting online or in person my entire term of council so far. There was actually one meeting last week or the week before where I attended two meetings at the same time because I made choices to leave and enter one meeting so that I could hear debates on certain topics that I was meant to be part of. That is what happens. That is what we have to do. In that time, in my entire council term, I've had surgery. I still haven't missed a council meeting. So there are reasons to miss council meetings. And if you are sick, please do not come in. But please don't attend online because we don't know if you're sick and have taken medication that can affect your judgment. We don't know these things. If you're sick, just sit it out. It isn't worth it. So thank you for...
Are there any other speakers? Councillor Reardon.
Yeah, thank you, Madam Mayor. I'm just thinking it's a little bit step too far. And what is the ramifications if you turn up and you're sick? Are you saying that we should be banned at the doorway or allowed in? I'll wait for the report to come back, but I just think this is going a little bit over the mark. I mean, I've been coming to council for many years and I've missed a few through illness and whatever, but there's so many things that can happen nowadays that we can't foresee what's going to be happening around the corner. What if you go out the door and fall over and break your leg? Does that mean for the next few meetings you can't attend, that you can't log in and find out what's going on? I'll wait for the report to come back.
Thank you. Are there any speakers?
Councillor Braun.
Councillor Braun.
Thank you, Madam Mayor. I am one of the councillors that is participating remotely tonight. However, I am in support of this motion on principle. I would like to see the report as well. I think that in the event that we are in a lockdown situation as we are at the moment, I think we should have the option to dial in remotely as myself and several other councillors are tonight, particularly if there are not going to be residents attending the meeting because of the lockdown situation. However, I think if we're not in a lockdown situation, absolutely, I think we should be attending because residents do come in to see us have these conversations and have these debates. And I think body language is a very important part of it. I think it will definitely alleviate some of the issues that we do have when we're online with not seeing and hearing people properly that are in chambers. So I think we should be attending chambers. And I absolutely agree that if you're sick, you're sick. With my day job, if I do work from home 2 or 3 days a week, if I'm sick, I'm expected to take a sick day and not dial in. If I'm taking painkillers or for whatever reason, if I'm not fit to attend the office, then I am not fit to attend remotely either. And that's a very big distinction in my day job. Also for your own like mental health and well-being, if you're sick, you need time to recuperate and you shouldn't be expending energy on thinking and making decisions and having to use brain power when your body needs to rest and recuperate. So I do support that we should be in chambers when we're not in a lockdown situation. However, I do hope that we would still have the option under these special circumstances. Thank you.
Thank you. Are there any other speakers? Councillor Hook.
I totally agree with Councillor Braun and Councillor Henderson. I mean, we should have the option to, in this situation, we should have the option to stay home and do it remotely. And if you go in, you know, you don't know what you're going to get, and you can pass on to your family in this situation. Look, it is important for us to go in as a councillor. Like, I don't agree, you know, I do not disagree with Councillor Buchanan. I supported what he was saying. It's just that, you know, sometimes there are certain things that you have to acknowledge that people can't really go in because of certain things that might happen in their family. They can join remotely. I don't see why we can't join remotely unless you have to be in there in person. So I'm not sure why is this going to this way. I know we have a responsibility to the right payers that we have to be there in person, but you know, on the other hand, we should have the opportunity or have the right to decide whether if you are not well or you're not, you know, comfortable going in, and then you should have the option to do so.
Thank you, Councillor. Councillor Jensen.
Thank you, Madam Mayor. Madam Mayor, I rise to support this motion. What we have before us really is I would like to think, a no-brainer. When we look at the actual composition of the council right now, for coming out of a pandemic and coming out of some of the strictest lockdown procedures, the second that we have had the capability for us to be here, we've got 10 out of 14 people in the chamber, one's left, but we've got a majority of councillors, overwhelming majority of councillors that have decided to make that decision to rock up to council, albeit in under different restrictions, albeit wearing masks when not speaking. But that's exactly the decision that majority of council have made. I just find it very hard to support having online meetings. Not to mention some of the previous feedback raised from people with regards to confidentiality or I guess safety or well-being of the individual, but purely on the basis of these are public meetings. These are meetings where members of the public have the ability to come into council, speak to their elected members, make deputations in front of the elected body, and indeed speak upon matters that are of importance to them. What happens if we have a meeting in which most members aren't present? I don't think it looks right for the council, where we're all not actually attending the chamber, but also it provides that additional disconnect between ourselves and the residents that we represent, where we don't actually attend the chamber to speak with them and to be face-to-face with them when they make a deputation or when they raise matters important to them. I think it is an issue that we do need to have a look at. What we've got is we don't have a radical motion that says this needs to be implemented right now. What this motion says before us is that we're looking for a report to be presented. We want to find out what those amendments are. We want to go through those amendments. We're happy to have that discussion. And then we're going to, hopefully, upon that report, implement a practical policy. So I'm happy to support this motion. I think it's great, and I'd also like to just go on the record and say that I think it's great that we've also got a majority of council in the chamber right now, particularly after coming out of some of the strictest lockdown procedures that our state's faced. And commend the motion and thank all members.
Thank you, Councillor Vaughan.
I have already spoken. Thank you, Madam Mayor.
Okay, oh, you have too. Was there anyone else? Councillor Brook.
Support the motion. Councillor Buchanan, code of practice for formal code of practice is code of practice for meeting procedures. Is that okay if I just get sneaked in there?
That's what it is.
That made it clearer to everyone. Is the seconder happy with that? It's only clarifying, I understand that. Councillor Cannon, would you like to run?
Oh, just a brief one, Mayor. And look, I appreciate Councillor Redden's concerns, but as Councillor Redden would know better than anyone, all I'm proposing is doing what council's practice has been forever and a day. When the Act was amended previously to allow us to have remote participation for committee meetings, there was long debates and discussion, and the council did that. We've allowed that. Under the ministerial directions, under the COVID directions, that had to be implemented earlier on, you know, probably less than 12 years ago. I think it was around April or May or maybe even May 2020. The government, or the parliament rather, enabled the Minister of Local Government to suspend certain sections of the Local Government Act, enable them to cater for state emergency directions issued by the state coordinator. And what that meant is that the council had the ability, if it chose to amend our own meeting procedures to allow participation at council meetings via online and not in person. They had to do that because the Act was very rigid in its wording and they weren't able to comply with COVID directions. You know, there was one of those catch-22 situations that the law clearly said you had to be there, but we also had to comply with the COVID directions. So the only blunt instrument that the government, the parliament had in that time was to allow the minister of the day to suspend certain sections of the Local Government Act. One of these was the sections. It is the intent of the Local Government Act that you must be at council meetings. That is the intent. And the intent of when the minister, the parliament, allowed that section of the Act to be suspended, the intent was that when there is a COVID lockdown, that we had that ability to meet remotely. The wording of our policy and the change that we made as part of our code of meeting practice, our amendment to the code of practice for meeting procedures, was to extend that carte blanche to any council meeting. Not whether it's due to, you know, a lockdown or whatever. It was that you could just attend remotely, period. Now, that's all well and good. We've had it in action. We've seen it in action. I think people's records reflect on itself in terms of participation. That's up to individuals. My personal view that we should be here unless there is a COVID direction that says, sorry, you're not exempt, you're not classified as essential, you're staying home. Well, then absolutely. We will reflect the minister's, well, the parliament's intent of then suspending relevant section of the Local Government Act to allow us to participate online. Yes, I fully appreciate there's always circumstances that we may not be able to attend. I fully get that. And, you know, it's important that you have the opportunity to participate. You do. You've got subcommittee meetings, committee meetings, things like that. There's still that opportunity. If you're really unhappy with the decision the council made on that one meeting that you weren't able to make it, guess what, you've always got the opportunity to move a rescission motion or, you know, if you feel that strongly about it. So there are those provisions under the meeting procedures to enable you to do that. So, look, I think as Councillor Jensen pointed out, I'm not saying these are the changes that are happening now. We're saying let's look at the amendments to reflect the intent of the changes we've got before us. And look, I'm still open. There could be some exceptions to the rule. You know, yes, this is the intent, unless, you know, your car broke down on the way. I don't care. I don't know. But there could be other things that you could be factored in. One that I'm not really interested in trying to accommodate is the sick one. You know, as Councillor Braun rightly said, if you're sick, you're sick. You know, in a workplace, you have to take sick leave. You're not allowed to participate in doing your day job for whatever reason. And the same should apply here. You know, if you have to work, well, guess what? With all due respect, your person who's employing you ain't going to be allowing you to be, you know, attending a council meeting. You know, it's in their time. So, you know, if you're travelling home from work or whatever, again, there's that duty of care stuff. You know, do we allow someone to participate in the meeting while they're travelling? You know, there's a range of things. So I think the simplest and the most easiest way is, you know, what's being proposed. And I didn't put a time frame on it. We can come back, you know, the next month, whatever, we can go from there.
I'd now like to put that motion. All those in favour? Against? Motion is carried.
Hang on. How did we know who online voted?
Sorry?
All in favour? Well, we didn't.
They did vote. I saw their hands. Could you vote again, please? Are you...
All those in favour?
All those in favour? Against, they did vote before I saw their hands. Okay, moving on now. Councillor Buchanan, did you have something?
Yes, Madam Mayor. I would like to move... should have written this down. That the City of Salisbury acknowledges and thanks the General Manager for City Development, Terry Sutcliffe, for his dedicated years of service. To the council and our community, and that the City of Salisbury wish Mr. Sutcliffe all the best, our best wishes for his future endeavours.
I'm happy to second. Second by Councillor Reynolds.
Thank you, Councillor Reynolds. Madam Mayor, where do I start? Besides the fact that acknowledging that this is Terry's last meeting, and it is a somewhat of a sad occasion for all of us. I'm certain that Terry moving on will be not only a huge loss in terms of the advice and support that we receive at council, but certainly the team that he leads. And should be very proud of the many achievements that Terry has done, has worked with all of us on trying to achieve for our council since he started with us, I think, in 2013 or 14. It's been a while. I just want to particularly pay my personal respects and appreciation of having, you know, been the chair of Policy and Planning Committee for a few years now, and having the opportunity to work closely with Terry on a number of projects, and has always kept me well briefed and on top of things, and times where I haven't been fully across the agenda has certainly provided that very good, quick, professional advice to help keep things ticking. I think it would be remiss as a council if we didn't publicly acknowledge that Terry has certainly played a huge role in some of the big achievements in this organisation and this council. Some of the things that both Councillor Kalita and I worked closely with on Terry and were very appreciative was the boardwalk development in Paralowie, for example. And members would recall, particularly Councillor Reynolds and others, that the Diamond Road
development that went, you know, pretty well, and we're benefiting certainly from those experiences learned from those two projects rolling out to the Walker Pines one, same as the one that's happening at Parra Hills. One of the things that, you know, I do know Terry, always the absolute professional, is, you know, I'm, on the one hand, I make no apologies, but during that, the whole hub saga, I think my views on the issue was very well known. And Terry was the project director, or whatever the term was that we gave for the hub, and did a fantastic job. I probably created a little bit of extra work on top of what was probably a very, very big work to begin with. And Terry handled it all with absolute professionalism and delivered on, and led a team and delivered on what is the building we're in now, and a project that very much came in on budget, you know, by and large, and more importantly, some of the issues that were outside of his control, he has certainly done his best to make sure that they are still being followed up in terms of some of the handover stuff. So it should be, Terry should be absolutely commended for that. The other thing that Terry should also be noted is that he oversaw a number of transitions when he came to our council. In terms of our own internal planning department, you know, we won't go into all the history with Terry's predecessor, but Terry certainly took over a challenging time in our council and made some big changes going back to that department and really improved governance and a range of other things and should be absolutely commended for that. And, you know, I always said that Terry was on Capringa's loss was our game, and I still stick to that to this day. The other thing, Terry, you know, should be commended. The a lot of the changes that have happened in terms of very significant master plans that have been taken, and some very significant development plan amendments that have happened around the council. Whether I agreed with them or not, again, use the Kamara Drive one in Salisbury Heights. Yes, I didn't agree with the council's position on that, but again, Terry was the absolute professional and was able to deal and provide me all the information I requested in a timely fashion, regardless of my views. And the other thing that I really thoroughly enjoyed working with Terry on is the revitalisation strategy, the master plan for the city centre. We started that process going back probably just a little bit before Terry arrived, and when John was in the role of Director of Strategic Planning, and Terry has certainly, you know, carried that forward and should be proud to take a huge amount of credibility and response and credit for, I guess, what we've had between delivering us at the moment. And the next stage of that is the development of Church Street, and John's very much integral to what Terry has done. And, you know, I could go on, the list goes on, but Terry's probably, he's certainly not one who likes to have praise, because he, as I've said, a professional who would always say that he, you know, leads a very good team and is supported by a very good team. And that team is not only under him, but it's the executive team, which he's been a very solid member of. And the one last thing I will mention is probably one of the biggest transformations and biggest things, and I'm glad he waited to choose to move on until this was in place, was the BDI Act that's coming, and some very significant changes there. So he certainly left us in a good place. We've had the transition to the new planning design process. We've got a great team under Terry that I know is more than capable in terms of carrying us through and making sure that that part of council's process is obviously delivered on. It's a very important part of council's work. And again, I just would like to thank the general manager for everything he's done, and more importantly, wish him and his wife and family all the best in what would no doubt be a well-deserved break, and whatever the Terry decides to do with it.
Councillor Jensen.
Does Councillor Reynolds second a wish?
He seconded it already.
Fantastic. Thank you, Madam Mayor. I'd like to rise to support this motion and extend my personal thanks to Terry for not only his contribution to the council, but indeed contribution I feel to myself as a councillor, particularly over the course of taking over strategic property development as a subcommittee. I can definitely say I came in as a newcomer. I came in as someone that hadn't previously been on the committee and wasn't across a lot of the grand projects and certainly the core focus of the subcommittee in the extent of members that have previously been on it. I can certainly say that Terry, of his own volition, made sure that I was well briefed, probably copying some of Councillor McKinnon's sentiments, but well briefed, informed, certainly felt a lot more competent chairing those meetings with the briefings that Terry provided, and certainly the word Councillor Buchanan used, professionalism. I think that's a word that all of us can agree with, Terry, professionalism, absolute, yeah, professionalism. I'd certainly also like to draw back to my time on resource and governance. Terry always provided sound advice, certainly made sure that we were well informed and had the answers to just about everything. So thanks very much for your contribution, Terry, and I look forward to your future endeavours and well deserved.
We have a general round of applause. Thank you. Moving on now, are there any other business?
Terry, want to say?
Oh, we haven't moved it. Of course. Do you want to speak?
No.
Yes. Feel free. In that case, I'd now like to put that motion. All those in favour? Against? Carried. And everyone's voted over there. Thank you.
Unanimous, I think it was.
Unanimous. Of course, why wouldn't it be? And now, are the business and motions without notice? We're now moving onto the confidential items. They're going to be done a little different. Please bear with me. It has come through a recommendation from the new governance manager. So we're going to move all the confidential items individually, get the confidentiality on all of them, and then move to the items themselves. So I'm starting with 13.1. Do I have a move? Someone move into confidential? Councillor Woodman, then seconded by Councillor Hood. All those in favour? Against? Carried. Item 13.2. Moved by Councillor Reardon, seconded by Councillor Perlita. All those in favour? Against? Carried. Item 13.3, moved into confidentiality, Councillor Hood, seconded by Councillor Woodman. All those in favour? Against? Carried. 13.4, someone move into confidentiality, Councillor Jensen, seconded by Councillor Reardon. All those in favour? Against? Carried. 13.5, someone move the confidentiality, Councillor Reardon, Councillor Grenfell. All those in favour? Against? Carried. 13.6, someone like to move into confidentiality, Councillor Jensen, Councillor Grenfell. All those in favour? Carried. But now moving on to the items.